is not going to get that man today. No, because I'm going to get him.
This is the Hagman and Hagman Report for today. It is Friday, October 9th, 2015. I'm Doug Hagman in studio with my son, fellow investigator, fellow researcher, Joe Hagman. Together, we are the Hagman and Hagman Report. Brock, what's the matter?
It just shows you getting ready.
Oh, okay. I'm not sure that goes out. Does that go out?
This is the preview screen. I don't have the preview up right now. Yeah. This is the actual stream. So.
Oh, wow.
And folks, we're working on the camera coming in and out. You know how it's, we thought it was the graphics behind us, the motion of the graphics behind us moving the camera in and out.
A lot of things going on here.
And there's no auto freeze frame for the cameras that we're working with, but we will deal with it. That's a very minor issue. But we have a great show for you tonight.
Yeah. Well, first of all, let me just say, we are the Hagman and Hagman Report. We broadcast live every weeknight, Monday through Friday. 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time on the Global Star Radio Network. So glad to be a part of the Global Star Radio Network. And live on YouTube, folks. Go to HagmanandHagman.com. That's HagmanandHagman.com. And click on the link to the Global Star. Global Star, click on that link as well to listen. Or click on the link if you'd like to watch us in high-def video. Click on that link. It's on the right-hand side. You can't miss it. And you can tune us in. And... yes, tonight we've got just a fantastic show for you planned. I've got to say that we're really excited with everything going on. Do we have John on? Or
yes, we do.
Okay. All right. Because of the mad rush before, just right before the show, I didn't. Something I want to bring up here on the computer. By the way, I talked to John too about the Paul McGuire, about his prayer conference yesterday, and it was really something. So I would urge everyone, you know, as Paul McGuire has these prayer conferences, ladies and gentlemen, please visit, if you're within anywhere near North Hollywood, there should be, in my estimation, there should be Christians that lining the streets, and people should be talking, saying, you know, what's going on? Because it's just what a fantastic event. Anyway, that, and by the way, the Babylon Code. Folks, if you don't have your own copy, please get it. Oh, my goodness.
I haven't read it yet.
Paul McGuire.
I'm going to order it this weekend, and yeah. I'm going to hopefully read it before the next week's up.
I am just, it's just an amazing book. You think you know things, but you don't. And I just want to thank Paul McGuire and Troy Anderson for writing just a tremendous book. Portions of tonight's broadcast, ladies and gentlemen, brought to you by AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. That's AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. Visit their website at AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. Also, HealthMasters.com. And again, you know, thanks for tuning in. John, it's great to have you, my buddy. John Roberts. By the way, let's give him a proper introduction. I didn't do that just now. I'm still flustered from...
John Robertson has been on the show before. He is not only a previous guest, but a friend and an integral part of the show. Really the mind and the worker behind HH Connections, which is a program where people who are listeners of our show, who want to meet other people in their areas where they live of like mind. John, am I correct? That's HHConnections at startmail.com, that website?
Yes, that's correct. And you know, it's just so cool sometimes how the Lord works, because part of what we're going to talk about tonight, probably in the second hour, and I'll map out the architecture of what I've got for the show here in a moment, but it's really true that the Lord will close certain doors, and then he'll open doors in front of us, and we need to have faith in him to trust that he's closing doors, and we need to have the discernment of the Holy Spirit to know which open doors to step through. So I am pleased to announce that whereas HH Connections has been relatively on the back burner. We had to sunset anything but direct requests for connections over the previous couple months. I am now available to begin integrally working daily with HH Connections for the foreseeable future. So, folks, if you want to meet fellow Hagman family members in your area or really anywhere in the world, I think we have like 27 countries now, and we have 48 of the 50 states represented. Go ahead and drop us a line at hhconnections@startmail.com. Again, that's HH for Hagman and Hagman, but it's just HH, connections, plural, at startmail.com. And this is real important because we do get a very heavy volume of email there now. If you want to be connected to listeners, to Hagman family members, please put connect me in the subject line because we serve those and give those priority. Whereas we love communicating with all of our new friends through HH Connections, it can be a little overwhelming at times. So for new folks and new listeners and those who maybe tried to get on board HH Connections back in June, July, when we had to kind of slow it down a little bit for expediency's sake, go ahead and put connect me in that subject line, and we're going to get to you first. So I'm actually very pleased to be part of it again. I sent out my first few emails to connect new people just, 4 days ago. So, yeah.
Well, that's awesome, John.
It's a lot of fun.
And on behalf of the listeners.
It's been a real blessing.
And here at Hagman & Hagman, we can't thank you enough for the initiative and the time and effort you've put into that. I know many people have been helped by that, and it's been a blessing to so many. So thank you so much for your time and your volunteering and your insight. I mean, this was your idea, and Chance and Jeannie and everybody else who helps. You know, God bless you guys.
Well, hey, you know, first of all, let me say that it's not only my pleasure, but it's an honor. Folks, let me be clear about, let me elaborate quickly on what Joe just touched on. HH Connections, I won't go into how it started or where the inspiration came from, because that's a story in and of itself. But suffice it to say, HH Connections, folks, has enabled friendships to begin and fellowship to grow literally all over the world. Hagman listeners from Sweden to Costa Rica have found common interests, whether it's in scripture or matters of preparation and what have you. And I can't tell you how good it feels when I get an email that two new friendships have been made. And the ones that really knock me over are when I get an email that a new home church has been planted, which has happened all over the country. And the best part, and Doug, you and I talked about this a couple weeks ago, and let me be clear, HH Connections is totally grassroots. I came up with the idea about a year ago. However, I encourage people to jump on StartMail, communicate with me, we'll have a brief dialogue, and start an HH Connections in your community, because I've got people in Austin, Dallas, Houston, Kansas City, the Carolinas, St. Catharines, Ontario, Canada, that have started HH Connections in their own local area. And as far as I know, you know, I may be sitting at home one night or cleaning the house or something, and there's an HH Connections meeting going on somewhere. And that's a major honor. It's really cool to do something like that for the kingdom. It's just been a great blessing. I don't know what else to say. I'm still kind of wowed by it.
Well, amen to that. And folks, for those of you who may be new listeners, John has been a guest on once before in a professional capacity to talk about, he's our Hollywood insider. Not only has he been on before to talk about the occult nature and secret societies and the things that happen, satanic ritual abuse that happens in Hollywood, but he's also going to be a speaker at the upcoming conference in Dallas, Hear the Watchmen Conference, and the organizer of the event will be joining us in the third hour, top of the third hour, to talk with John, myself, and my father, and his name is Mike, and we're going to talk a little bit about that conference in hour number three. But first off, we're going to get into some of the depths of Hollywood, and I know my dad has some things prepared, and with talking with John, they have prepared some excellent insight into the darkness that is around and really runs Hollywood. And then in hour number two, we're going to take a little walk of faith, if you will, and continue our discussion from hour one. But let's, Dad, I'm going to turn it over to you. And you direct us on where you want to start.
All right. John, I'm going to need a minute here. What I was doing and what I've done is I put together just a wild history of really the occult and the sinister force. I mean, really a wild history about Hollywood. And, you know, this encompasses, and we often talk about, I'm just going to go from memory. I'm not even going to go from notes. I'm going to go from memory here because, honestly, my notes are buried on my computer and I can't get to them right
now.
Doug,
if I may.
Go ahead.
If I may interject quickly, Doug, I do have a 920 second intro that covers just a couple of the points that I have to offer in the first hour. Would you like me to go ahead and give that to the Hackman family and give you a moment to
That'll give us some structure. Go ahead.
Okay, perfect. Well, folks, first of all, I'm just so pleased to sit down at the Hagman family kitchen table once again. And as Joe said, I was a guest back on June 24th, and the title of that show was Hollywood is a Satanic Death Cult. And in that show, the thesis, as I stated in the title, I wanted to demonstrate was that the entire Hollywood machine is full of suicide and murder and drug overdose and alcoholism and sellouts and burnouts of beautiful people and all of these things. And certainly there is occultism that goes all the way back to Genesis 10, to the time of Nimrod and ancient Babylon. However, the entire machine in and of itself is, in fact, a death cult. From page to stage, that's what Hollywood is all about. Now, last night at the Paul McGuire prayer meeting, and by the way, I just want to give a tip of the hat to what Doug said. If you live, I would say if you live in the state of California or Nevada, these are worth attending. The Holy Spirit comes to town in ways that I have seen few times in my life, and the anointing comes down on Paul pretty strong. And it's different each time, too. There's a teaching. Sometimes it's a longer teaching. Sometimes a little more brief. And I think it just kind of depends on where the Lord leads Paul. That being said, Paul McGuire noted last night that ancient Babylon was the world's first attempt at three things. Ancient Babylon was the first attempt at a one-world government. Ancient Babylon was the first attempt at a one-world religion. And ancient Babylon was the first attempt at a one-world economy. Now, I would suggest to everybody listening tonight that Hollywood, which is known, colloquially, or has been noted as being Babylon. You know, there's been books written, Hollywood Babylon. Babylon's been recreated on sound stages and backlots over the years, the most famous of which at the intersection of Sunset Boulevard and Hollywood Boulevard back in the day of D.W. Griffith. I would submit to everyone listening tonight, Hollywood is the conditioning factory that's constantly massaging our spirits and warping our minds. And what it's doing, folks, is it's moving us toward mystery Babylon, toward the Babylon of Revelation 18, okay? And so whether the occultism is deeply hidden, as is the case with Disney, and I know Doug's got some notes on Disney, or whether it's, you know, completely in your face, like Scientology or Ordo Templi Orientis, known as OTO, and the Process Church, bottom line, folks, Satan and occultism own, manage, and run Hollywood, page to stage, period. They've got this town sewn up. This is their rear headquarters. This is their HQ. And I would also note that I think it's interesting that the Christian inroads into successful filmmaking of late, I'm thinking specifically of Tear Flicks and their runaway smash hit, both artistically and financially, God's Not Dead. PureFlix is in Phoenix, and there's a reason for that. And I would add that Passion of the Christ was also made in Italy. You try to bring a good, strong, Christian-themed project into Hollywood, and they'll either shut you down financially or they'll dump you in the weeds, and I'm not kidding. In fact, folks, even in Hollywood's golden era, the flip side of the Walk of Fame, folks, it was rife with horrific death and suicide and alcoholism and rape and blackmailing. And, you know, it's like one day, even back in the 1940s and 50s, you'd sit in one of these pagan movie palaces and you'd watch a new face kiss the screen, you know, and instantly fall in love. And then the very next night, that beautiful new face could oftentimes be drowned face down in regurgitated martinis and Seconal. So even in Hollywood's golden era, there's always been the Luciferian control that we talked about on the June 24th show. So in conclusion, I want to just offer this on a personal note. In my 16 years working here in town, you know, I went from kind of arrogantly sort of cocktail party guy, you know, I'm in the biz, to pretty much a walking civil war, which is what I became. Every day at 6 a.m., I'd drive to Burbank or drive to the West Side, and I'd be listening to True News or Caravan or Doug and Joe. And I would pull up to the lot, and I would feel like a hypocrite on one side of the studio gate. And then I would drive across that sort of magic threshold, and I would feel like a turncoat on the other side, because I was doing these shows and felt compelled by the Holy Spirit to do these shows, you know, basically implicating the industry that's put food on my table for the last 16 years. So in the second hour, or toward the end of the first hour, I'm going to tell the Hagman family, I'm going to tell all of you folks what's happened since June 24th, since our previous Hollywood show. And one of the things Paul and I talked about last night, I was blessed enough to get one-on-one time with him after the event. You know, I said, Paul, I've got this real stirring in my spirit that in the Hagman family and in the among the Caravanners and Rick Wiles' audience, I think God is really moving his remnant around right now. I mean, he's telling people, get out of your comfort zone, get out from under your damp safety blanket. It's time to give up your whoopee, put on your big boy pants, and make a move for the kingdom. And that's hard to do. You know, it's like my dad said the other night, if I go from Universal Studios to Fox, that doesn't require any faith. That's just a transition. All that requires is half a tank of gas. But what I want to talk about with each and every one of you is building the prayer life and finding the faith in our Savior to step out or to step away from a place you may be and into the place that God has for you, as he has one for me as well, and where he wants you to be so that you can be of service, so that you're not impotent to his plans and to the kingdom. And then, you know, if Doug and Joe want to, we can go ahead and take some calls. And then we're going to take a few moments to talk about this conference in Dallas in March. And, you know, having been on the inside of the planning of the conference a little bit, folks, a lot of love has gone into this thing. Nathan Liao is really sort of our headliner, and boy, is he spiritually pumped. So we'll talk about that in the third hour.
John, if we can.
And that being said.
Real quick, you were a part of the Montana conference, the Whitestone Remnant Conference. Can you just briefly explain to people how the power of the Holy Spirit moved through that conference?
Oh, man, I'm glad you asked. Whew, it's a good thing I'm sitting down. I'm glad you asked me to do that. Okay, so folks, last May, it was May 29th through June 1st, I believe, of 2014, Steve Quayle and Michael Bennett put together a conference called the Whitestone Remnant Conference. It was in Bozeman, Montana. I got the impression that most of us had never been to Bozeman. I certainly hadn't. In fact, I'd never been to Montana.
No.
Doug and Joe, first time in the Northwest, right?
Getting there, it was my first, that was an experience, I'm going to tell you.
it really was. So what happened, folks, is about 500 of the remnant body gathered at a Holiday Inn in Bozeman, Montana, a town of 29,000 people in a beautiful valley in Montana. And it had very much a springtime feel to it. And when we got there, I didn't know what to think because there was also a Montana State Sheriff's Convention going on there. So you walked into the hotel, and there were these men and women all armed, walking around, but with blazers on and with street clothes. And I was thinking, wow, this remnant body is really serious. And then we realized, no, in fact, this is the Sheriff's Convention that's sharing the hotel with us. But we got settled in the first evening, and we hit the floor running with Russ Dizdar, and I'm sure most of you have heard Russ here on the Hagman and Hagman Report, and then Russ was followed by another another, well, really unknown to me, Pastor John Kyle, who's also a deliverance minister. I can tell you folks, on a personal note, when I arrived in Bozeman, Montana, I smoked a pack of American Spirit Blues a day. Kept it hidden, didn't feel good about it, felt like a cruddy Christian. But it was an old habit. It was one of the last ones to die. Pastor John Kyle encouraged us to pray with him and to seek deliverance of any demon or any demonic influence that might have a stronghold built in us. Well, certainly smoking for me was one of those. I haven't smoked a cigarette since I walked out of Pastor John Kyle's meeting that night.
Wow.
So I left that habit in Bozeman, Montana. And so there was a lot of power in that place. And then skipping for there's two more anecdotal things I'll say about Bozeman. When Pastor Langford gave the Sunday sermon, and Doug and Joe, I hope you both remember this, because I'll never forget it. There was a young lady sitting about four or five rows in front of me. And at an appropriate time, I think Pastor Langford may have concluded his sermon, she stood up and sang a hymn a cappella. Do you guys remember that?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was so moving. It's like this one girl had the courage to stand up in a room of 500-plus people. I don't remember the hymn she sang, but she had tears streaming from her eyes and a beautiful voice.
Yeah, Pastor Langford's wife.
Oh, was that Pastor Langford's wife?
Yes, it was.
Well, it was a remarkable moment. As I said, I was five or six rows back. And then lastly, the baptism was scheduled. I'd actually met Michael Bennett that morning, and we had breakfast. And he had said that the baptism that Sunday, late morning, early afternoon, had been scheduled for 40 people. And it's my understanding that just over 100 were baptized that morning, myself included. Got baptized by Pastor Langford and Steve Quayle. And I'll tell you folks what. Two things happen after you get baptized by Pastor Langford and Steve Quayle. Number one, you figure you better shape up, get your life ship shape and trust the Lord. And number two, you come under heavy duty attack really fast.
Yeah.
So Bozeman was phenomenal. It was a chance for. Oh, and one other thing I'll say is that the most unique thing about Bozeman, folks, was demographics didn't mean anything there. It was like you just became friends with people because you were standing within speaking range of them. I mean, age didn't matter. Socioeconomic strata didn't matter. What denomination are you? That didn't matter. In fact, I don't remember having any of those conversations. All that mattered was that you were there and you love the Lord and you're awake and you know that we're in the 11th hour, 59th minute. And when it comes to faith and when it comes to faith in the resurrection and faith in your sins being washed by the blood of Jesus, that you're not messing around. That's what Bozeman was about.
Yeah, and I'd just like to add that, you know, for me, the Holy Spirit moved tremendously, and you know how you feel when somebody's talking or a speaker's talking, and it seemed like every speaker that talked would get that overwhelming emotional Holy Spirit feeling, you know, where you want to tear up and so joyful. That happened so many times there. It was a spiritual experience. And I wanted you to talk about that and us to bring that up to say this, that I have a feeling that it will be the same way in Dallas with the people that are going to be there and the care and thought that's being put into this upcoming conference. And I hope the power of God's there the way it was in Bozeman, because that was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for me. But not to take away,
Joe.
We'll get into the conference in the third hour. I don't want to take away from the presentation you and my dad have put together for tonight.
All right.
Let me just say this quickly to conclude these remarks, folks. Here's what it's about. Okay, so whether it's Nathan Leal's prayer conference about 2 weeks ago in Priest River, Idaho, or the Whitestone Remnant last year in Bozeman, or Doug and Joe's recent forays into Ohio and Orlando, or coming out to be with us all in Dallas in March. This is what it's about, is that the remnant body comes together, and this is kind of what, well, it's not kind of, it's what inspired me to do HH Connections, is it's about bringing us all together, because together iron sharpens iron, and we're an army, and we stand shoulder to shoulder. And when you start to tremble and you start to have fear, you start to feel that fear replace your faith. You've got a brother or a sister on both of your shoulders going, hey, stand firm, man, I'm right behind you. And it's powerful. And yes, Joe, you weren't the only big boy there rolling some tears. That's no doubt about that.
it was truly. These conferences are truly a very emotional and the soul touching. I mean, it touches your very soul, these conferences, and Pastor Langford through his ministry and others. I mean, it's just fabulous, and it's to rub shoulders with people. And you know, John, I've been able to spend time with, like, Pastor Langford and others behind the scenes, and they're the greatest people on earth. They really are, and they're just like, I mean, you couldn't ask for any finer people, and you couldn't ask for any more truer Christians than those.
Amen, brother. In fact, we had about an hour with Pastor Langford and his wife in the airport. It's myself and the ASW team. And I remember Pastor Langford's wife was so sweet. She said to myself and Chance, she said, "Well, if you guys are ever in the neighborhood," referring to their home, "just come on by. We've got a full house, but we'll find some place to put you." I mean, Southern hospitality and just like you said, I mean, just people serving the Lord and people on a faith walk, taking it one day at a time. No ego. I can't wait to see them again.
Oh, it's gonna be fantastic. That's for sure. Well, John, I'm gonna leave the more dramatic with your situation for you to disclose. But I just want to say this, ladies and gentlemen. You know, we think about Hollywood. Marilyn Monroe once said that Hollywood is a place where they'll pay you $1,000 for a kiss, and 50 cents for your soul. Now, I think that's very true. I've talked to a lot of people. No, you know what? Let me rephrase that. I've talked to a couple of key people from Hollywood, names that you'd recognize. You know, I suspect, and I've had occasion from the investigative business to talk with a couple of people. I've had the occasion to work for a brief period of time with one of the stars, key stars of the old A-Team. Back, you know, the original A-Team. I don't know how many people remember that. I've been told some things that you know, and also I've done my own researches and talked with John and John in his capacity with working within the Hollywood structure. Now, everyone listening to this, I believe, this broadcast, I think most people have been deluded into thinking that Hollywood with, you know, you see these reality shows on television. What comes to mind? Oh, how dysfunctional these people are. Right? I mean, obviously you'd think they're dysfunctional. But
and on a side note, you know, all those reality shows are scripted. They're fake.
Right,
there
exactly.
Nothing real about anything that's on TV, commercials, reality shows, or otherwise.
Well, that's very true. Yeah.
Sorry.
No,
I just appreciate you pointing that out, Joe.
John,
yeah. Sorry.
You have some firsthand information you want to share with respect to that, or?
I used to love watching American Pickers. You know, that's the show where the two guys drive around and they dig through people's junk and they find these precious artifacts, and I used to love watching Pawn Stars too.
Oh, well, wait a minute! You're not going to tell me American Pickers is all just twisted?
And
right?
I know Storage Wars is fake.
Here's the deal: I know how much you both love history, as do I. And it's an interesting side note. Most of the Watchmen I've met really love history. It seems to go hand in hand with allowing the Lord to place you up on the wall, I think. But Pawn Stars and American Pickers, dig them both because of the historical, you know, context and the artifacts and whatnot. I worked with a guy about 2 years ago who said, "John, I hate to tell you this, but I put a penny farthing in a barn for American Pickers." And I said, "A penny farthing?" I knew that meant something. I was, you know, but I didn't know what. And looked it up on my phone. And a penny farthing is one of those old bicycles, the early bicycles where the cranks, the pedals are up on the front, big tire, and then you have a little tiny tire in the back. So I worked with a gentleman whose job it was to source and place what the stars of the show would then dig out and bid on. So the locations are not scripted, but the treasures that they pull out are. And as far as Pawn Stars goes, I don't know to what degree that is scripted, but I do know that they source those artifacts, particularly the American colonial stuff, and the early American historical stuff. They source that from all over the Western hemisphere. I mean, they source it from vendors that I use as well. So
interesting.
There you go. Yeah.
Well,
I'll tell you what. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say that, you know, the Hollywood itself, it has been built or has built up, I should say, the lives of the stars to the viewers. And when they have lost their use, they certainly waste no time in dragging them into the mud, through the mud, when the elite owners and producers of the entertainment industry where they're no longer useful to them. Okay, so what we're seeing is not just a, you know, not just a kind of a morality crash. We're seeing this huge plane crash, I suppose, if you're, you know, making comparisons. People in Hollywood, you know, one thing that tires me, John, is this anti-Semitic bent toward people in Hollywood. It's interesting. Any forums that you're on, it doesn't matter if they're survival forums or political forums or Alex Jones InfoWars or YouTube forums. We get them here. Oh, it's the Jews. They own Hollywood. It's the Jews. They own the banks. It's the Jews. They own this. It's the Jews. They own that. It's a Jewish conspiracy. They own the banks. You know.
John B. Wells says it's the Jews.
Yeah.
John B. Wells hates it too. By the way, he's sick of it.
In fact, John and I were talking about this here, I think it was last week. And
it was a great show, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah, and off air, the ignorance behind those statements, in my view. I mean, anyone who comes out and says that, to it's a Jewish conspiracy, has not done the research and has not done their homework. Do you agree?
I do agree, and I think that without... in fact, it's interesting because doing these shows on Hollywood has opened up my confidence in researching so many other avenues that all together would comprise what we sort of term being awake. And there does need to be attention paid to the specific Zionist movement within the Jewish being of Jewish ethnicity. However, the same can be said for Catholics when you look at some of the very serious allegations that have been levied against the Jesuits with an awful lot of historical evidence, I would say, that would certainly hold up in a court of law. So no, I do not in any way, shape, or form subscribe to the anti-Semitism. In fact, some of the finest people I've met since I've lived here in L.A., I've been here 18 years, have just by chance been Jewish, and the reason for that is there's just a much higher population of Jews in Los Angeles than in San Francisco. Right. But I've been invited to Seder dinner, and in fact, I've had some really interesting conversations with Greg Jackson over the past couple of months about some of this anti-Semitism and how it plays into Hollywood, as well as the stuff coming out of D.C., because many of the international banks happen to be run by Jewish families, although I think they're Jewish primarily in name only. I from what I've seen, okay, the Hollywood thing is a mess, and I would be a poor excuse for a watchman. In fact, I think I would be cowering in the shadows of an alley, not up on the wall, if I didn't just take this moment in my life to stand up and say, look, this is what's going on. And tonight what I'm going to hit you folks with, and I'm going to start right now.
Hey John, before you start, I just want to finish my thought on this. When I started talking about this being a Jewish conspiracy, you know, and saying that it's ridiculous and the anti-Semitic stuff, what I found with respect to Hollywood, it's my belief, this is an occult conspiracy. Let's put it right into the lap of the occult.
Yeah, and if people who are part of the occult were, Jewish in lineage, just like some are German in lineage or Irish in lineage, or none of that matters. When they become the occult, they become the children of Satan. They're not
exactly
of any religious denomination.
And really, there's. And the reason that we need to take a look at Hollywood is because right now, and I'm going to turn back to you, John. Right now, so many people in Hollywood, or so many people, are watching TV, watching movies, going to the what are they say, people laugh when they say motion pictures, you know, or the silver screen. That's a funny too, right? So many young people are going to movies and watching television, and we're being programmed, and this is predictive programming that we're being subjected to. Television and movie scenarios are now being shown, and I can guarantee you this is advance warning to what you're going to be seeing in the future, you know. But people don't know this, and there's like several different layers to this. You've got the predictive programming, you've got the psychological battle over your mind being perpetuated by those in positions of authority. You've got television and movies presenting, giving us scenarios about what's going to be happening in the future. You've got, I'll just say this: if the powers that be want people to take vaccinations, you know, they'll program that the vaccinations in the movies, for example. Now, the Walt Disney, by the way, the whole thing with Walt Disney plays a big role into this occult programming. It's a separate part. Disney is kind of a separate part. But really, the last thing I want to say is if you look carefully, you can see the subliminal 9/11 markers that were placed into the movies. And how can that possibly be just by mere coincidence? And you know, to me, it was developed over time. So I believe that was real, and it's undeniable. You've got all of these issues. So working together, these are working for our destruction, the destruction of society. And the other thing I want to mention, and I'll turn it back over to you. The other thing I want to mention is, you know, one thing, there are certain people I really have issues with. And I'll just say those people who review movies, only because, you know what I'm talking about, like the Siskel and Ebert kind of people, not with them personally, of course, but with the idea of reviewing movies. I find it difficult for any intelligent, sane, and rational human being to take a look at the drivel coming out of Hollywood, looking at it and saying, well, this is a bad film, or this is a waste of 3 hours or 2.5 hours or whatever it was. And without being able to recognize the programming, the subliminal, overt or covert, subtle or hit you over the head programming that's taking place, or the downright directional, you know, attention grabbing stuff going on. It just amazes me that we don't have that these people don't recognize that these reviewers, these people that are saying, oh, it's a good movie, go see it, bad movie, don't go see it, that they are part of the deception. And I'm just blown away, and I'm blown away by people who are so entranced that they don't have a clue.
Yeah, and if I can, you know, back to the, you know, blaming one group or the other, there are two groups of people, as I said, and the Bible clearly distinguishes the seed line, his seed line, and the serpent's seed line. And beyond those two seed lines, nothing else should be considered. In reality, we are all humans. We are all a big family. You know, our ancestors all stem back to the same people. You know, Abraham, Noah, Moses, Adam, Eve, to God who created us. And there's either the seed line of the Lord or the seed line of the serpent. And we can leave it at that.
And as you're talking, as people are listening, I would like to mention, you know, to me, there are levels of Hollywood circles of hell, okay, and one can look no further. One has to look no further than Stanley Kubrick. He tried to open really a door to the abyss with his film Eyes Wide Shut, but you know it's not what was in that very disturbing film. What's not what was seen, but was probably left on the cutting room floor that would have been most disturbing. Kenneth Anger, Hollywood Babylon. Okay, that name, Kenneth Anger. Folks, you would do well to, I believe, to research that name. You would also do well to understand the filmmaker, people like filmmaker David Lynch, and his, I believe he was the one that was responsible for Mulholland Drive, a movie that I happened to get snookered into seeing. This is back long ago, and my goodness, you talk about occult brainwashing in that particular movie, Mulholland Drive. But having said all of that, John, Laurel Canyon, I think it's important to understand. Why don't you take us back? Because you and I spoke earlier today. Take us back in history and tell us the real history, some of the important things with respect to what's going on in, or what had gone on in Hollywood. And we can leave
Disney alone.
You go ahead. We're going to turn the chair over to you.
Here's what I'd like to do, folks. First of all, I was saving this quote for later, but I've decided while I've been listening to you both, Doug and Joe, that I'm just going to take the gloves off tonight, because in the second hour when I explain to the Hagman family what's happened to me in the interim since my June 24th show with the Hagman and Hagman Report,
that's key,
and also the July 28th show I did on Caravan to Midnight, at this point, I've got the kingdom to gain and really nothing to lose, so I'm taking the gloves off as of right now. Okay, here's a quote. Quote, "Television was the major mainstream infiltration for the new satanic religion," end quote. Let me read that one more time. Television was the major mainstream infiltration for the new satanic religion. And that was quoted by Anton LaVey, the founder of the Church of Satan in San Francisco, California. A good friend of Sammy Davis Jr., actually. In fact, a lot of stars were attracted to the Church of Satan. And that was because Anton LaVey and his minions had insight into enabling them to learn to channel. We talked about that on the June 24th show. Folks, before I go any further, let me just reiterate that if, for those of you who are new Hagman listeners or were unable to join us on June 24th, when you have a moment, go back in the archives and check that show out, because there was a lot of content in that show that gives a lot of background and a lot of context and a lot of real deep history. But I specifically did two things that I feel like I was a little bit cowardly in. Number one, I didn't go after the cults the way that I wanted to, because I was afraid. And number two, I wanted to tell more personal experiences, which is what I'm going to do tonight. I've got a couple about Disney and one that happened at Warner Brothers. But let's go back in history quickly. I touched on this with Paul last night. 1960s, okay, General Electric is basically one of, what, maybe five corporations that's running the United States, okay? You got the three big car manufacturers, General Electric, Boeing, and a handful of others. But GE is certainly at the top of the pile. And if you look at their 2012 and 2013 tax returns, they're still at the top of the pile. General Electric began to work surreptitiously with Jack Parsons of the JPL fame here in Pasadena. And what they developed was tonal harmonics and visual brain stimuli with television that would, within 60 seconds of an individual sitting down and turning on the TV, that individual's brain activity would skip from what they call beta waves, okay, to alpha waves. Now, beta waves are your left brain. That's your left brain activity. That's your critical thinking activity. Alpha waves are the right side of the brain, where, and that's the side of the brain that allows one allow oneself to be put into a hypnotic trance. Okay, so General Electric, with research from MK Ultra as well as MK Naomi, that's MK Naomi. I think most folks are on the listening to the show are familiar with MK Ultra. What they did, Jack Parsons and GE, figured out that the thing to do was to get people into a hypnotic trance as quickly as possible. Shut off your critical thinking, open up your maybe sort of kind of what if mushier side, that is the side that allows hypnosis to even work. And the reason why was simple, because it would create an indefinable desire to buy whatever product they presented during commercial breaks. It did not take them long to discover that, because all a television show is, folks, is glue. it glues together the commercials. If there were no commercials, there'd be no TV. So, and we all joke about that in the business, that what we make is glue. And so what they realized, folks, is if we can hypnotize a man into buying a different razor blade, or if we can hypnotize a woman into changing pantyhose, then we can use the same technology to hypnotize them with the content of the show. And that's when the conditioning began, okay? And then what happened was they used what's called the Overton window approach. I don't want to digress too far here, but the Overton window is a really good term for the Hagman family of listeners to understand. It was named after a guy named Charles Overton, who was the state superintendent of education in Michigan back in the 1980s. And the Overton window is very simple to understand. It's a term used in Washington, D.C. all the time. The Overton window means you want to take society from point A to point B, but you know you can't get them there in a straight shot. They'll never go for it. They'll break out the torches and the pitchforks. So what you do is you slowly massage and condition and move society from point A to point B. You move them two steps forward, and then you give them a false victory, make them believe their grassroots efforts are actually working, and one step back.
Yeah.
And you move them three steps forward and give them a bigger false victory and one step back. But ultimately, you've already moved them three steps toward your ultimate goal.
Variation of the Fabian socialist.
That's the basic concept of the Overton window.
A variation of the Fabian window. Yeah.
It was, in fact, that's where it came from, Fabian socialists. That's right. Exactly right. From the whole Bertrand Russell clan. So the Overton window was applied in the 1960s to Hollywood, and especially to television very quickly. Pretty soon you started seeing shows that celebrated the new age of feminism, shows like That Girl and Mary Tyler Moore, and then later on Murphy Brown. And what those shows demonstrated on the surface were powerful women who knew who they were, and they didn't necessarily need a man. They were open to a man, but didn't necessarily need one because they're in the big city and they're going to make it. Of course, if you do your homework, you realize that what was going on in the late 60s and early 70s is the government was going broke. Nixon had just taken us off the bimetallic standard and turned our currency into funny money. And they figured out, the powers that be figured out, we need to double our tax base. And the way to do that is to take women out of the home and put them to work. And the best way to make women want to do that is give them That Girl, Mary Tyler Moore, Murphy Brown, etc. And so that's been Hollywood's job. Hollywood is the engine that enables the Overton window to move us all to the ultimate New World Order agenda, as I mentioned in my opening remarks with what Genesis 10 Babylon was.
And John,
the first attempt at one world government, religion, and economy.
If I could just jump in here, you're exactly right. It was a Rockefeller initiative. I forget the think tank, but the main purpose of getting the other half of the population to work was for tax purposes and to help further break up the family and weaken the family structure. You're exactly right.
And I think people, real quick, I'll jump in here too, and I think people have to understand that just about everything that we're seeing on television, in the movies, and even in society comes from the think tank, the Tavistock Institute. And branched off the Tavistock Institute now, here in America, is the Aspen Institute, which is also an influential think tank. And people, folks, I'm sure our audience members know about the Tavistock Institute and their American faces. However, you may not know about the Aspen Institute and the role it plays. And, John, what you said, too, by the way, the American faces, the Stanford Research Center, the Stanford Research, just one degree of separation from Tavistock, was responsible for the counterculture revolution here in America. And as you had pointed out, for example, many of the Hollywood insiders or the stars of Hollywood were in fact associated with Aleister Crowley. Okay, the face of evil personified, and the Church of Satan in the process, the Church of the Final Judgment, and so I'll just go ahead, sir. I'll just leave it at that.
Well, you're exactly right, and thank you for mentioning those. I would like to add to that list. We've got Tavistock, Aspen, and Stanford, the Stanford Research but let us not also forget MIT.
That's true.
And also University of Chicago, where Estabrook or Esterhaus? Estabrook, I believe, where he did all of his research. Without what that man did, I mean, he practically was Aleister Crowley. Folks, I'll just mention this quickly. I don't normally do this, or I wouldn't normally do this, but I know that Doug and Joe have a very warm relationship with John Wells. I did a four-hour show on Caravan to Midnight on July 28th. It's episode 339. If you are a caravaner and you have access to it, please check it out. And the reason I mention that is I went into depth on Aleister Crowley, on his writings, and what his ultimate doctrine, which was called Thelema. And Thelema is the famous text on Jay-Z's hoodie that says, "Do what thou wilt." And the full quote is, "Wilt shall be the whole of the law. Love is the law under will." That's the entire quote.
Right.
And that's Aleister Crowley and his doctrine of Thelema. Well, let's see. We've got about, 5 minutes to break. So here's what I'd like to do, gentlemen. I intentionally left out some personal stories on June 24th because I thought I might have 6 months or a year left in the industry, and now I realize I don't. So what I'd like to do is tell a quick story, actually two, and these revolve around Disney. And I've got to take everybody back to September of 2003. Folks, we have to interrupt this with a top of the hour break, but there is an area of the Disney lot, which is in Burbank, that's sort of the back of the lot. It's the Burbank and Alameda corner of the lot. And back there, they have stages 7 and 8, and also the animation department. It's for people who work on the lot every day. We think of it as the back of the lot. For civilians, it looks like the front of the lot. It's the more attractive side of the lot. When I was working on the show Alias back in 2003, I had to spend an afternoon in a conference room, sitting in a sexual harassment class. Now, all the major lots have these sexual harassment classes, and they are hypocrisy in capital letters, underlined in a neon sign. Okay, I mean, you leave the set of the show you're working on to go and have lawyers tell you that you are not to personally do any of the things that you're filming currently. And the reason I even bring this up is, on that show, but I worked on Alias at the same time on the same lot. Folks, that show, 8 Simple Rules for Dating My Teenage Daughter, starred John Ritter. And this is, man, you talk about a showstopper. I think everybody enjoyed John Ritter to an extent. I think we could probably say that he was one of America's funny men that more people liked than not. He was only 54 years old. And in the middle of rehearsal, he collapsed, and he was sweating profusely, and he began vomiting uncontrollably. Yep. And complaining of chest pains.
Hey, John.
And they were able to go. Yeah.
Hold that story.
We're going to have you repeat portions of that because I
we're up against
pressed the button. Too.
Yeah, we're up against the top of the hour break. We lost some audio on YouTube for the last 2 minutes there. When we come back, Number two with our Hollywood insider, Mr. John Robertson. We will be right back on the Hagman and Hagman Report on this Friday, October 9th, 2015 on Global Star Radio Network. Stay with us. And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to hour number two on this Friday, October 9th, 2015 edition of the Hagman & Hagman Report. We're joined by our Hollywood insider, John R., tonight, and he is going to be sharing a plethora of occult news inside Hollywood, the dark depths of Hollywood, and what we don't see that comes across the TV screen. And we're just going
to... Before we turn it over to John, I just want to mention, folks, please, if you haven't done so already, I mean, time is short, it seems like. Look what's going on in the Middle East. Look what's going on inside the Capitol, okay? If you think that the John Boehner McCarthy issue is a small issue, is a diversion, that's not a diversion. That strikes at the heart of chaos, and chaos is right here, right now, and it's only going to get worse. It's only going to get more divisive. Note what McCarthy, I believe it was McCarthy, said. I don't want to be known as the or one of the. I shouldn't. I'm not sure who said it, but I don't want to be the. I don't want to be the person who was known as dividing America. Folks, that was not, I mean, that was a clear message as to what's going on behind the scenes. But having said all of that, get prepared now, because if you're not prepared for what's coming, you know, you're going to be scrambling at the last minute. And I'm speaking to those people who have the means to do so. Go to AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com and certainly stock up on your preps, your long-term storable food. They are our go-to company for all things food, long-term storable food related, survival related. So please, that's AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. The other thing too, folks, is this. Healthmasters.com. That's healthmasters.com. You don't want to get caught in this really firestorm that's coming without, well, feeling bad, okay? In other words, physically bad. Check out Healthmasters, healthmasters.com. At the very least, sign up for their newsletter. Now, their newsletter is not just about health. It's about a number of things. It's well worth it. Dr. Ted Brower. But healthmasters.com, please sign up for that as well. But check out their products, because their products are far and above any products that you'll ever get on the store shelf. It just won't happen. If you see some of their videos of their manufacturing, their plants, oh my goodness, it's they're like, you know, level 5 plants. I mean, it's incredible. That's healthmasters.com. And, of course, AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. Our guest, as Joe said tonight, is John Robertson from Hollywood. And he's been with us for quite some time in terms of, part of our program. We have a warm, soft heart for Mr. Robertson. And he's sharing what Hollywood's all about. And now, buckle up, because, folks, John is going to be sharing some things in the second hour that are just going to be absolutely incredible. And due to my ignorant pushing of a button here on the one visual computer, and you folks, there's so many controls here, it's like a space shuttle back here. Anyway, we John, if you could repeat the last 2 minutes or the 2 minutes as we discussed during the break for the people that lost sound.
Well, absolutely, I'd be happy to. And folks, I just want to mention two things quickly. First of all, I would be remiss if I didn't just give a quick thanks, a quick shout out to the team at American Survival Wholesale, and seriously, Merrill and Chance and Bloss, Sergeant Pedrino, and Steven, and all the people down there that make that whole thing work. That folks, they do so much more than provide preparedness items that are crucial to the times ahead. Make no mistake about it, these people are my overwatch, okay? I couldn't do what I do without them. They blow the shofar. They back me up in prayer. They're willing to go muzzle down. And there's been times in the past 3 months where they've made it clear to me, if they want to get a piece of you, John, they're coming through a wall of American Survival Wholesale and Cowboys first. And that makes a big difference, because there have been some scary moments in the last 3 months. So they're just a very special group of people. And the other thing I want to say is put your seatbelts on, folks. I'm going to hit the skinny pedal on the right. We're going to move really fast because what I'm going to do in the second hour is I'm going to tell stories that I witnessed personally that I sort of withheld on the June 24th show A little bit out of fear, but also there's just so much information. I mean, I probably do 10 of these shows easily. So we were talking about Disney, and I want we opened up with talking about the Tavistock Institute and Aspen, MIT and the Stanford Research Institute. And let me be clear, okay? Walt Disney had direct ties with the FBI, and Walt Disney had alleged involvement with Project Monarch, going all the way back to the impetus of the project with the immigration of the Nazi scientists after World War II. The reason I bring this up is I was working on a Disney show 2 years ago, a kid show, and I had the opportunity to question a gentleman whose family goes back three generations with the Walt Disney family. And when I say goes back with, I mean this gentleman's father wrote many of the big 1960s Disney hits, okay, like Cat from Outer Space or Apple Dumpling Gang, Toby Tyler Goes to the Circus, all those great big Disney features from the 60s. And his grandfather was a director for Disney, so they go way back. And I said to this gentleman, I said, you know, I think that there's some stuff to look at with Disney. And he got really mad at me. And we were actually pretty good friends, too. He got really angry, and he said to me, and I quote, you know, I used to have Christmas with him, referring to Disney. You know, I used to have Christmas with him. You shouldn't talk about things you're not 100% sure of, John, end quote. Boy, I felt about 2 inches tall. And so I made inquiries at Disney about you know, the Disney family to people I knew who could shed some light on it. These people are Christians and they're awake, but man, he shut me down really hard and really fast. So,
well, I'll just say this, John, to your defense. The Satanic Rituals by Anton LaVey. Within LaVey's writing, he writes, the tiny bells typical of Russian liturgical ceremony should be used whenever appropriate to the rite, meaning the satanic rite, and played in the rhythm associated with the Avakad. If in doubt, Modest Mussorgsky or Walt Disney can be your guides. And the idea that Walt Disney was a secret Satanist, folks, you know, people think it's urban legend. It's considered urban legend to many. And, you know, consider some of the facts. He had a long, ongoing association, or acquaintance, I should say, with Anton LaVey, the author of the Satanic Bible and the leader of the Church and Satan. And likewise, LaVey considered him highly to such an extent that he would openly state that the followers of Satan should consider Walt Disney as one of their guides. So go ahead, sir.
Well, he's also one of the first to experiment with cryogenics. Michael Penn, Sean Penn's, I believe, old younger brother, who's a pop artist, wrote a song, a tongue-in-cheek song about 20, 25 years ago called Disney's a Snow Cone. And it just referred to the fact that he believes that by decapitation and, you know, cryogenically preserving his head, that he could one day come back to life. So how that is any different from the message that we're getting from the Google people and from all of the transhumanists and you know, singularity people at this point. I don't think there's any difference except 30 years technology. So quickly with Disney. So I spent about 3 or 4 years on the Disney lot, and again, I was working on Alias. This is back in 02 through 05. And just to quickly recap, I was sitting on the front side of the lot in a sexual harassment training. And at the end of that video, after they showed all of the classic sexual harassment do's and don'ts, they had a little 3-minute vignette that showed an ostensibly Christian woman speaking to a coworker. They were working behind a jewelry counter in a retail environment. And she simply invites her to church, and she says, I'm praying for you. I know you're going through a hard time. I'm really praying for you. And the lady that she's talking to, you know, just has looks of kind of consternation or perhaps resentment on her face. What Disney was telling us in no uncertain terms is your proselytizing of your Christian faith will be considered no different in the realm of human resources than sexual harassment. And so that, interestingly, that happened a few months before the tragedy that happened on stage 7 and 8, which is right next door to the room I was in. on the show Eight Simple Rules for Dating My Teenage Daughter. Now, that was that star John Ritter, and it ran for a couple of seasons. And what happened is on September 11, 2003, in the middle of rehearsal, now that's a three-camera show, so they rehearse 3 days a week, and then they have two tape nights. It's different than the way they shoot episodics. So they were in rehearsal, and Mr. Ritter hit the deck, and he was sweating profusely, and he began vomiting uncontrollably, and he began complaining of chest pain. And they, with just not a second to lose, whisked him across the street to Providence St. Joseph Medical Center. More on that in a minute. But what happened over there is the doctors misdiagnosed John's condition as a standard heart attack. And what it was, in fact, Hagman family, it was an aortic dissection, okay? So unfortunately, on September 11, 2003, John Ritter, beloved comedian, I think most Americans really love the guy after his time on Three's Company, but he died on the operating table at St. Joseph's at 10:48 p.m. John Ritter was 54 years old. Now, where I come into the story is the next day was Friday, and my crew had to strike a set that was beneath stage 7 and 8 in a music, what they call the music rehearsal room, and we had done a laboratory, a real ornate, intricate lab, again, for the show Alias. So first thing in the morning, we've got the trucks out there and probably an 8-man crew, and we're striking, bringing all the set dressing and all the set deck stuff up an elevator to ground level and out to the trucks. Now, John Ritter's stage was right there in the same lobby, sharing the same elevators that we were using to strike the set. And folks, I'm telling you that I will never forget this. Unit production managers, showrunners, writers, producers, executive producers, line producers, sound mixers, co-actors, actresses, the whole cadre of the whole cast and crew that it takes to make a show. These people were meandering around, literally meandering, like almost like they were sleepwalking, meandering around, completely listless, lifeless in their eyes. Okay, the slumped shoulders, nobody talking to anybody else. Every once in a while, you'd look out into your periphery and see two people embracing and crying because they had lost their star and their friend, and on a personal note, they're fairly certain that they're going to lose their job. Now, it turns out that James Gardner, who was still alive at the time, actually joined the show, and they made it through that season. So when I say that Hollywood is a satanic death cult, you know, stars drop dead right there on stage, as exemplified by John Ritter. I never interacted with him one-on-one. I was around him a lot. He seemed like a very kind man. Moving forward, this one I witnessed firsthand, and this is another really sad story. This happened at Warner Bros. I was working on Pretty Little Liars. It was either late 2011 or early 2012. It was our second season of the show.
Hey John, before you move on, I just want to make sure people know that John Ritter died. And I think you might have said this, but I want to make sure people understand this. On September 11th, 2003.
Yeah, he did say that.
Okay, but just again, yes, to hit that home, September 11th, 2003. And as you're listening to John and numbers, numerology, occult numerology is woven through Hollywood. But go ahead, sir. No.
By all means, Doug. And folks, in a moment, I'm going to talk about Hollywood corporate symbols. As soon as I finish the Warner Brothers story, we're going to talk about Hollywood corporate symbols, and then we're going to talk about pagan movie palaces from the golden era. And when I talk to you about some of these symbols, again, the numerology really comes into play. Personally, I used to discount numerology until I started really paying attention to what people like Doug and Paul McGuire would remind us of, which is it is not what we as Christians, as followers of Christ, believe that we're discussing. It is what they believe. It's what the initiates believe. We call them the Illuminati. They call themselves witches or high priests. It is what they believe. And if we're gonna chase their story, then we've got to read their story with an unbiased perspective. I used to think numerology was a joke until I got deeper into this and realized that it is anything but. Okay, on to Warner Brothers. So I'm working on Pretty Little Liars in season 2. And I was standing in my boss's office. Now, we're all on radio, so I'm on the production channel. I'm on channel one. Got a the same thing that the Secret Service wears. Got the little ear rig in my ear with a mic that hangs down my the front of my shirt. And I hear the first AD announce that we are having an we're doing an emergency evacuation of the stage, and all cast and crew will queue up in our emergency evacuation zone. Now, we had practiced this once, like a year earlier, and she was dead serious. So I had to announce to the other five guys in my boss's office, gentlemen, I'm not sure what's going on, but they're instructing me over the radio that we are to evacuate stage. Well, they thought I was joking, and I said, no, gentlemen, I'm not joking. They're instructing me on channel one that we are to go to the exit right now and evacuate stage. There's some kind of emergency. I don't know what. Well, the greensman on the show, and a greensman, as the title would imply, folks, is in charge of all things green. They place the trees, the shrubbery, the hedges, the ivy, the flowers, the plants. It's a big job. In Hollywood, they will disguise entire parking lots full of cars with these huge wagons that are covered in trees. I mean, they can literally make an entire parking lot go away by using greens. So greens is its own department. It's under my union local. It's under the same local as set decoration and property craftspeople, et cetera. So my buddy Dave was a greensman. Now, interestingly, I had worked late. This was on a Monday, and I had worked late with Dave on Friday night / Saturday morning because he had about 200 greens to strike off the set in the back lot where the lagoon is at Warner Brothers. And I didn't want him to have to do it by himself. So I offered to pitch in and help him, and we worked for an extra 90 minutes well into Saturday morning, probably 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning when we wrapped up. And I was making fun of some of Dave's colleagues, because some of the greensmen can be a pretty colorful group. You know, they're kind of like modern-day pirates. And I was making fun of some of them in a good-humored way, but nonetheless making fun of them. And the last thing that Dave said to me that Friday night / Saturday morning, and we call those Fratterdays, by the way, he said, you know, John, the older I get, I just don't want to look at my fellow man and judge. You know, I just kind of want to do it. That's what he said to me. Well, let's flash forward to Monday. We are queuing up in our emergency zone outside of Stage 6, Warner Brothers. Well, come to find out, Dave had sat down in the effects coordinator's office. He pulled out his laptop. He literally wrote his own obituary. Okay, I don't have a copy of it. Even if I did, I wouldn't read it on air because Dave was my friend. But I'm not kidding. He wrote a two-paragraph, frankly, pretty verbose. It was very wordy, but very heartfelt. What would be considered, he didn't call it an obituary, but it certainly read exactly like one. And then he stood up after writing these couple of paragraphs on his laptop, and the entire back of his heart exploded. It just blew right out. He was dead by the time he hit the fire lane. So my buddy Dave, who, you know, I'd worked with for a couple of years, he's about 10 years older than me, 15 years older than me, good guy, he left Stage 6 feet first, never to collect a retirement check, never to see his family again. He came to work at Warner Brothers at 7 a.m. that morning, and he went into the afterlife at about 1 o'clock that afternoon. I actually went with about 10 of the cast and crew members back over to Providence St. Joseph, the same hospital they took John Ritter to. And I went in. I'll never forget this, Doug and Joe, and Hagman listeners, but I went into the trauma unit that they had placed him in, and they'd taken his shoes off, and he's laying there dead. And it's just so weird. I'm looking at this man who's dead, who was alive 2 hours ago. You know, he's working a regular, perfectly normal day. He wasn't even complaining of illness. And I just got on my knees and said an intercessory prayer for his soul. You know, I knew that he had had a rough life. He'd had a lot of ups and downs. His life seemed to be on the mend. I'm not exactly sure where he was with the Lord. And then I sat there for a couple hours. The crew and the cast, one by one, left. And I sat there and awaited his family so that when they arrived, they wouldn't find just... they wouldn't find his wife's husband and son's father dead there by himself. It's a day I'll never forget. And again, that was on the show Pretty Little Liars. So Hollywood, once you're in, there are no guarantees. Whether you're John Ritter or whether you're Lupe Velez, who I talked about on the last show, on the June 24th show, or whether you're Tony Scott, who jumped off the Vincent Thomas Bridge. Hollywood will take you when Hollywood wants you. And you're in the devil's lair. You're playing in a very, very dangerous environment. And the problem is that it's so alluring. It's like, I'm telling you, I've walked the red carpet a couple times, and when the flashbulbs are popping and the beautiful women are everywhere and I'm wearing a suit I can barely afford, it feels amazing. I mean, that's why people strive for it so hard, because by this terrestrial definition, it feels pretty awesome, okay? But by the definition of the kingdom of our Lord, it is prideful, number one. It is irrelevant to leading the lost back to the shepherd. It is a drought in desperate need of living water. And it is a place of beautiful people who are bereft because they know not themselves or their Savior. So they glitz it up, they glam it up, they throw some money at it, and everybody else clamors to be them. And I was one of them, clamoring just as hard as everybody else. I wanted a life of Lincoln Town cars and red carpets, and I had a writing capability that seemed to be backing me up. I thought I would mention quickly the sexual harassment training that we had at Warner Brothers on the same show. I'm going to be very brief on this, but it was such a joke. This attorney is standing in front of us on a different soundstage, not one of ours, some other show. I can't remember what show. And she just, you know, instructed us and kind of almost harangued us for about an hour about sexual harassment. You know, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't hug people, you can't ask anyone on a date, just, you know, don't. Basically, it's not about, you know, refraining from being creepy or inappropriate, but basically don't be a human being, okay? It's a handshake, and if they're uncomfortable with that, then don't even do that. And then we went back to our stage and spent the afternoon shooting a girl-on-girl scene where two teenage girls in the script are rolling around making out on the bed. And I remember hearing one of the executive producers say, quote unquote, I probably shouldn't say this quote. But let's just say that right, my safety valve just pops big time, Doug and Joe. But let's just say that for just coming out of a sexual harassment meeting, it demonstrated the hypocrisy and the confusion of Hollywood like no other moment could.
Oh, do tell.
And what's that?
Oh, do tell.
Yeah, you know what? I can't figure out a way to clean it up good enough. Let's just say that one of the executive producers apparently hadn't attended the sexual harassment meeting.
All right.
So it leaves cast and crew on a constantly unstable footing, because we're creating, and it's worse. Not only are we creating it, we're creating it and we're blasting it out to the whole world. This is the way to be. This is the way to live. This is the way to happiness. You're not happy because you don't have this. But if you have this, well, then your life will be just like an episode of Friends. Of course, if you look at Friends a little more deeply, you start wondering why six adults over the age of 30 live in a teeny tiny apartment. You know, Agenda 2030, anybody?
That so, and the oversexed, the oversexed, and I mean, there are so many layers to the Friends, the comedy. You know, it's amazing. Go ahead.
Well, I'm going to move forward. I want to talk for a minute about Hollywood corporate symbols. Now, this is one of those ones. This to me is like chemtrails, where it substantiates and supports what Scripture tells us about in the end times there being a great deception and even a falling away among the body. Because if you can't see, I would say, and I say this respectfully, a measured amount of Christian discernment is always in order, always. But you can use the common sense you use at the grocery store, the CVs, as follows. CVS is obviously the eye. It's the all-seeing eye, the same all-seeing eye that's at the top of the pyramid on the back of the $1 bill. That would be CVS. Now, Paramount's an interesting one. Paramount you have to look at a little more closely. Paramount, since its inception, is a pyramidic mountain. But what you need to recognize about that pyramidic mountain is that it is always surrounded by those stars. And if you count those stars, Doug and Joe, there's always 22 stars. And 22 symbolizes in numerology what they call the master builder. And the master builder is the little g god that enables one to achieve that which is hardly imaginable, quote unquote. 22 symbolizes the master builder, And the master builder, lower G God, gives the power to achieve that which is hardly imaginable. That's Paramount. Moving on, NBC. I've got a special love for NBC right now. NBC is an interesting one. You gotta dissect it a little bit. But NBC, my entire life, has been the rainbow-tailed peacock. It's on the side of all their buildings.
Mm-hmm.
When I was younger, NBC was quote, proud as a peacock, unquote. Now, you got to look up a little something about peacocks. First of all, they're not called peacocks. They're called peafowl because only the males are peacocks. Females are called peahens. And the males are the only ones with the beautiful tail feathers. They're actually in the pheasant family. And what the males do is they spread those tail feathers to attract attention. Now, as is very common in the animal kingdom, it attracts not only the attention of the females for whom they're trying to attract, but also other males as well. Use your own discernment, folks. I'm not going to make any conclusions here. I'm just suggesting that a rainbow-tailed peacock is probably not a mistake. The rainbow,
right?
The peacock. The Hagman family can draw their own conclusions. One of the ones that I find really just up in our face is the new Time Warner symbol that's been out for a couple of years now. You know, it's the eye with the elliptical swirls around it. Do a search on the Eye of Osiris or the Eye of Horus. That is clearly the Time Warner symbol. Once again, the all-seeing eye, the Luciferian eye that sees you, same as the CBS eye. And then lastly, Columbia, which is one of the ones, before I was knowledgeable, I always thought was one of the more beautiful logos and opening to films. And that would be what we thought was Columbia, the lower G goddess of freedom, bearing the torch of freedom, which is exactly what people think the Statue of Liberty is, too. But what Columbia really is Isis on the globe holding the Illuminati torch of the knowledge of the ancients. Now, knowledge of the ancients or knowledge of the elders is Luciferian knowledge. So, again, it's Hollywood's not hiding it from us, folks.
Not at
all. It's right in our faces. And yet what we do is, because we're so entranced and so mesmerized by what they present, it's almost like I think Christians just sort of stuff it to the back of their mind and think, well, I'm saved. I serve God. You know, I like going to the movies. And I mean, really, who doesn't like going to the movies? But we need to be very careful in these late days and these late hours. Moving on, I wanted to cover quickly something that I wanted to cover in the June 24th show. Even in the Hollywood's golden era, in the time of my grandparents, Satan had it sewn up so tight that the movie palaces in all the major cities, New York, Chicago, San Francisco, Dallas, Philadelphia, Boston, you name it, these are just some of the very common names. And I mean, these were movie palaces that could be found in all of those cities, not just one. Now, this is back when Hollywood was a vertical business structure, meaning that the studios with contract players and contract crew created the films, they distributed them themselves, and then they distributed them into their own theaters, and it was a single vertical up and down chain. That monopoly was eventually broken up in the early to mid-50s. But here are some names of some of the pagan movie palaces that you would find, and some of them you still find today. Orion, Odeon, Paramount, Venus, Parthenon, Arcata, the Apollo, Olympia, and the Orpheum. My point, Doug and Joe, is that even in the golden era, even in the era of, you know, William Wyler's The Best Years of Our Lives, and, you know, The Wizard of Oz, and Marty, and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, and all these great black and white films, even then, Lucifer knew how to attract the unknowledgeable and those who had their Ephesians 6 armor stuffed in the closet somewhere, probably where the Bible stuff too. He knew how to draw them into Hollywood recreated Luciferian pagan temples from the time of the Roman Empire or the Greek Empire or Babylon. He's drawing the people right back in to the Parthenon or the Odeon or the Olympia to watch the products that he's creating from start to finish. And people are paying to do it. And in so doing, they're financing Satan's very efforts.
Absolutely.
Doug, did you want to add anything?
No, you know what? Keep going, John. I mean,
you're running through a wealth of knowledge and information here.
If I can dare step back just momentarily, okay? I know you were far down the road here, but if I can just touch on this,
absolutely.
Okay? You know, we had mentioned Walt Disney, and I know that people get dizzy when I change topics and go back, but I just want to touch back on Disney, okay? And I know it's again. Indulge me, folks. If you look at his movies, a lot of his movies contain satanic themes and sexual themes, hidden occult symbolism and imagery. And folks, if you go back to Disney, the trademark signature contains three hidden sixes, which is really 666, the number of the beast in Revelation. Now, you might think, well, this is ridiculous. And I remember, John, I had somebody...
No, it isn't ridiculous. It's a fact.
But I'll tell you something. I had somebody... And this is how careful I think that we have to be, and how aware we have to be. I had somebody, really a nice guy, say, "Hey, let me help you out with your graphics." And this is now a decade ago. He created a logo for my company, okay, my investigative company. Well, and I thought, "Oh, that's great, great logo, thanks." You know, well. Wouldn't you know, when I started, after a while, somebody looked at it, and this is long before I was into symbology and imagery. They said, "Wait a minute, that looks like basically a Nazi cross, you know." And if you turn it a certain way and looked at it a certain way, my goodness, there it was. Now, the guy had no intent of doing this. You know, trust me, he had no intent of making this. Whether it was subliminal or something, I don't know. But I immediately stopped using that particular logo. But that's how easy, you know, it is. And but with Disney, of course, you know, one has to wonder where the six is located. Of course, the first part of the W, the daughter of the I, and then the Y. If you look carefully, you can see the sixes. So I just wanted to kind of step backward and offer our listeners that, because we were getting a couple of emails about the symbolism and, you know, the occult mind control and such, and sex and occult numerology. And this is all important. So thank you for indulging me on this. And again, that ties back to the occultist, Aleister Crowley, but go ahead and thank you, John, for allowing me to toss
absolutely.
It
you know, I just rue the fact that we have such an awesome family of listeners, but I remember having this feeling on June 20th as well, where there is so much to examine when you flip over the other side of that Hollywood Walk of Fame. Incidentally, folks, when you walk it would be west to east on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, you're looking at one pentagram after another. I just thought I'd mention that. I'd also mention that when you walk the south side of the street, west to east, you're looking at one pentagram after another with all of the stars' names spelled upside down, which is part of Aleister Crowley's teachings to recite things backwards and to write backwards and upside down.
As above, so below as well. Yep.
As above, so below. So even as you walk the actual Hollywood Walk of Fame, what you're looking at when you walk west to east on the south side of Hollywood Boulevard for many blocks is one pentagram after another with the stars' names as above, so below, written upside down. It's total Crowleyism. It's totally under the doctrine of Thelema. And if you folks are interested, by all means, email Doug and Joe. I have content ready to go right now that deals with Ordo Templi Orientis. I did a bunch of stuff on the Process Church of the Final Judgment and on Scientology since my June 24th show.
Scientology.
I did a lot of that with John Wells. Yeah, we really hit it hard. But the problem is that's an hour and 15 minutes of content right there. And what will happen is we'll miss talking about some of the important stuff I think that the Hagman family needs to hear tonight.
Well, you take go ahead and take us wherever, because we can always read. Scientology is not going anywhere. What happened to you?
We can have you back on, John.
And ladies and gentlemen, see, here's something I think everyone really should know about John. John paid some pretty heavy consequences And I'm going to let John talk about it, but at whenever he feels ready. But he paid some pretty heavy consequences through his association with Hagman and Hagman.com. And you don't, and yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, you don't think the powers that are the occult powers that you don't think that they don't listen to this show. I could tell you, I've heard from people in Hollywood who have said, "Man, you know, yeah, it's there are people who listen to this show, specific shows with specific guests. Paul McGuire being very a big one in this." Where people are really monitoring what we're saying and what he's saying, what we're all saying, because the exposure is there. So, John, take it away.
Yeah, that okay. So, folks, I'm being very serious with each and every one of you right now. I have had the blessing and the opportunity to speak on numerous occasions with Paul one-on-one about this very topic, and the level of infiltration at this point, the level of infusion, and the level of subterfuge that the enemy is now bringing to these frontline ministries. Let me put it in layman's terms. They figured us out, okay? So the time is now to square your shoulders, all right? Get your feet firmly planted, all right? If you want to fight in the Word, I highly recommend it. You better have your Bible at your side. And if you want to fight with your fists, I hope you're doing your push-ups, because it's 11th hour, 59th minute, folks. I'm not trying to be dramatic here. At the top of the third hour, I'm going to explain in detail what has happened to me over the course of doing four shows. It started February 17th with Doug and Joe when we talked almost off the top of my head about some Disney kids shows, and we talked about Hollywood in general. We did a one-hour segment on February 17th. That evolved to the June 24th show, which was a full three-hour show, which enabled me to get on with John B. Wells on July 28th. That was actually a four-hour show. And so there's been a lot of exposure, and each time I've pushed the envelope a little bit more, because each time when I pray, the Lord has stirred my spirit. And what he said to me, right before I did Caravan to Midnight, I had this conundrum for about a half a day where I knew who the Hagman family was, and I knew that I could read scripture all day long and pray all day long, and we could pray on our Ephesians 6 armor and do all these things. But Caravan to Midnight, now John B. Wells is undisputably a child of Christ, no doubt about it. He's a Christian. And the Lord is really moving in that show. Okay, Tim Alberino was on the day after me, and then within the next 2 weeks he had Russ Dizdar and Paul McGuire, and then, of course, Doug Ewell on last week. So the Christians are coming to town on Caravan to Midnight. But I found myself in a conundrum. I didn't want to do the Hagman show from June 24th over again. I didn't want to just do a redo. But I wanted to use some of the material. But the Lord had instructed me for that June 24th show to use scripture first. Use my word, okay? We as Christians believe that the word is God. So it's not just God's word. The word is God. So the Lord said, use my word to instruct the listeners as to how it is in accordance to my will, and then show them by what you've observed in your years in Hollywood how Satan, as one of his five aspects of who he is, being one of them being the counterfeiter, how he spins and warps and distorts the goodness that God gives us. You see, Satan can't create. He can only pervert. He can only vulgarize. So as I explained on Caravan, Hagman family, hear me out. You do not have a neutral relationship with Satan. Each and every person hearing my voice tonight, I hope you're walking with the Lord. But if you're sitting on the fence, like Joe said many months ago, you're going to fall the direction you're leaning. And you do not have a neutral relationship with Satan. Folks, Satan hates you. He hates you. And he wants to see your death and demise, and he wants to drag your soul to hell. Period. That's the story. And that's what Hollywood was designed for. I wish I could give you some better news, but that's been the plan from minute one. Go back to the June 24th show, hour number one. I gave a pretty concise history of how the town was formed. Now, that being said, there's a blessing in it. God gave each of us a divine spark of creativity. Out of his love for us, he gave us just the smallest ability to create, to create the Hagman and Hagman Report, or to create the show I'm sharing with you, or to create a Bible study, or to create a men's group, or to create, I don't know, a children's sports ministry, or whatever it is your heart's being pulled to. And because we have that divinity, that spark inside us to create, folks, Satan hates you. because he doesn't have it. He can only pervert. He can only vulgarize, and he can only counterfeit, and it drives him crazy. So when you examine Hollywood as one of the great machines at Satan's disposal, you have to always keep in mind that what appears to be creativity is really a counterfeit, and I don't want to go too far off the reservation tonight, but I highly recommend Paul McGuire's book. Well, I recommend them all. Babylon Code is available for pre-order right now, but
It's shipping
two
now.
Years ago.
Just got ours Wednesday.
Man, you talk about tempting. He had a hard copy right there in front of me last night, and I was like, gimme. But his book, Mass Awakening, was fantastic. That was the previous one. But the book before that is where you need to start. That's Prophecy for the Future of America.
Yeah.
In it, he explains from the time of Nimrod, from the time of Babel, Genesis 10, to now, what Hollywood calls the literary monomyth is the same story told over and over and over again. And that story is the story that we're told of in Genesis 10, that Nimrod was a mighty hunter, but he wasn't a hunter of wild game. He was a hunter of men's souls because he himself wanted to become a god. And that's what the Hollywood monomyth is all about. It's all about wanting to become a god. And the closest we have to gods in America in present day are the stars and the luminaries in Hollywood. Now, that being said, I'm going to look at the machine a little bit here just for about 5 minutes or so. I'm going to blaze through a couple of really macabre golden age of Hollywood deaths. Now, I'm only doing this because I saw such similarities and such sadness. When I worked on the June 24th show, the Lupe Velez story really touched my heart, and it got me looking at other 1940s and 50s stars and how they passed from this mortal coil. So I'm going to share a few with you. I'm going to start with Alan Ladd. Folks, Alan Ladd was huge. He was Paramount's number one go-to guy. Okay, he was the biggest A-list actor at Paramount. Incidentally, he was also the star of an old radio show that I liked a lot, on Box 13.
He was Betty White's husband, right?
What's that?
Betty White's husband?
I believe he was. I didn't have that in my notes, but I believe he was married to Betty White for a short time. Yeah, I think he had a couple of marriages. I'll look that up for next time. In fact, I'll make a note of it here. So Alan Ladd, a couple of his pictures, folks. This Gun for Hire. He had a role as a reporter toward the end of Citizen Kane. I mean, he's in Citizen Kane. And he was paired with Veronica Lake in 7 film noir pictures. Now, personally, one of my favorite genres of film is film noir. And, you know, I don't want to digress, but he starred with Veronica Lake in The Key, which was written by Dashiell Hammett. So that would have that real 1940s, 50s kind of gumshoe detective. Well, what I would call the Doug Hagman genre. So he was paired with Veronica Lake in 7 different film noir pictures, including Dashiell Hammett's The Key, made for Paramount, and subsequently Raymond Chandler, the other big Hollywood gumshoe detective writer, in The Blue Dahlia.
But by the way, John, I stand corrected. That was Alan Lund. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I didn't remember seeing Betty White. Now, let me scratch
that
off.
I'm such a, you know. I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you what, Doug, before leaving Paramount, Alan Ladd made his biggest picture probably of his career, and that's Shane. And Shane really was like kerosene on the old Western campfire. I mean, that took the Western genre and just blew it out. Pretty soon, every little boy in 1950s America has got the 2 6 guns on his hips Christmas morning, you know, in the cowboy hat. Everybody wanted to be Shane. Shane was a genre picture that really motivated the tastes of the average American moviegoer for a season. Incidentally, Shane was directed by George Stevens, and I used to work in a restaurant 15 years ago called Kate Mantellini. It was a big napkin deal restaurant in Beverly Hills, right across the street from the Writers Guild Theater and across the street from ICM, one of the big agencies. And I used to wait on Mrs. George Stevens, George Stevens' wife, the director of Shane. And even Mrs. George Stevens, who owned a couple blocks of Sunset Boulevard, I kid you not, she owned a couple blocks of Sunset Boulevard, very, very rich lady, she was absolutely cuckoo. I mean, Hollywood had really taken a toll on this poor woman. She used to come into the restaurant and tell everybody she was Shirley Temple, and she would throw pennies and dimes at the waiters. And, you know, you Von Dahms of Hollywood. And in the 90s, she was just this lonely, diminished old woman that owned a you know, $1 billion worth of real estate, and would throw pocket change at waiters and waitresses. I actually got some of that change thrown directly at me. back to Alan Ladd. January 29th, 1954, Ladd was found dead at his home in Palm Springs, and the cause of death, folks, was cerebral edema. That's a nice way of saying he died from drinking, okay? He was found alone, dead, surrounded by booze bottles and Seconal. And that was the end of Alan Ladd. That was the end of Shane. Well, he did a lot of pictures with Veronica Lake, so let's take a look at Veronica Lake. Veronica Lake returned to the U.S. from traveling abroad. She was already a huge star. And she was complaining of stomach pain. They checked her into the Medical Center of Vermont in Burlington, and she was diagnosed with acute hepatitis. And she died just a couple of days later at the Medical Center of Vermont from years of alcohol abuse. And again, a beautiful star is dead. Moving on. This one is personal to me. Jack Cassidy. Now, it's personal to me because I've worked with his son, Ryan Cassidy. And Ryan, if you ever hear this, man, I've really enjoyed your friendship, and I hope I treat your dad with respect here. Ryan and I worked together on some Disney shows, and he's a very, very nice man. His brothers are David Cassidy and Sean Cassidy, of Partridge Family fame. And in fact, Jack Cassidy was married to Shirley Jones in 1956, also of Partridge Family fame. Now, Jack Cassidy's got TV credits of his own, no doubt about it. He was a good-looking guy, too, by the way. He was in Gunsmoke. He was on the Alfred Hitchcock Hour. He did Bewitched, Get Smart. He was on Batgirl, and he was on Hawaii Five-0. Oh, but on December 11th, 1976, and this is a sad one, he was living alone in a penthouse apartment in West Hollywood, just off the strip. He had invited Shirley Jones over for drinks, but they were divorced at the time. She declined his invitation. You get the impression they were still friends. So he went out, and he ate an Italian dinner alone, and he got pretty drunk. There are rumors that he was taking substantial amounts of Benzedrine as well, because he struggled with keeping his weight down, and actually had some conflict with the studios about his weight. So he was, you know, using 1960s era speed to keep his weight down. So he went out, ate an Italian dinner, had too much to drink, returned to his West Hollywood penthouse, where he proceeded to drink more, and he passed out on the sofa with a lit cigarette. Folks, Jack Cassidy's body was burned beyond recognition. He was ID'd early that morning by dental records and a ring that he wore bearing the Cassidy family crest. And once again, you know, Americans love Jack Cassidy, and he died alone, basically self-immolated, drunk and on drugs from a dropped cigarette.
John, let me ask you, as we're going through these, could some of these be, for example, like in the case of Robin Williams, in the cases of other stars, I'm trying to think, there are a few others, Heath Ledger, the guy in New York that here recently, and anyway, could these be sacrifices, if you will? Could they be? They could. Okay.
They could. With Jack Cassidy, I think this was perhaps just an unfortunate accident. And a lonely one at that. But I'll tell you what. I have listed here in just a moment some other notable horrific Hollywood deaths. And then once we're past that, we'll be in the third hour. I'm going to take just a quick second to recap two of the what I believe are the reasons within the content of that June 24th show that got me in trouble. And then I'm going to take the first portion of the third hour to describe the trouble I've gotten into, and then I want to extrapolate that into talking for about 20 or 30 minutes about faith and about having the faith to move to where God would have us be. If that's something.
Sorry about that. John, you with me there?
Here?
Yeah,
yes,
yeah. We just had a little blip there, and that's on our end. So hang with us. Or go ahead and continue as if nothing happened.
How much time do I have till top of the hour? known for her 1944 film role in Laura, where she played the title character. She was also nominated for an Oscar for Best Actress for her performance as Ellen Burnett Harlan in Leave Her to Heaven, and that was in 1945. She had a known romance with the returned World War II hero, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, and it's really sad. She loved Kennedy big time, and it's suggested that Kennedy really loved her, too. But Jean Tierney was not Catholic, and Kennedy was, and he made it clear to her that he was chartering a career in politics, and therefore she could never be considered a potential Mrs. Kennedy. And that left Jean in a delicate and a fragile mental state. She started her acting career really young. She was only 16. And after her first screen test, she felt like she sounded like Minnie Mouse. Her voice was very high and very tonal. And so she began smoking cigarettes, and she began the life of a heavy smoker, 3 to 4 packs a day. Anyway, moving forward, by the mid-50s, she was suffering manic depression, and she underwent extensive shock treatments in Connecticut. And then in December of 1957, there was a suicide attempt in New York City at her mother's apartment. She actually stood on the ledge of her mother's apartment building 14 floors up for about 20 minutes. And she didn't jump. She returned to the apartment, and at that point, her family had her admitted to the Menninger Clinic in Topeka, Kansas. Now, the following year, she was pronounced cured, and she was released from the clinic, and she took a job. Get this. Huge Hollywood star. She took a job in retail selling dresses in a small dress shop. And it was kind of her attempt to reintegrate into society. Of course, she was eventually discovered working in the dress shop and made a picture for Fox. She made a smash comeback in 1962 in the film Advise and Consent. But like all the others I've just profiled, Jean Tierney, lovely actress, died of a terribly painful case of emphysema in Houston in 1991. Folks, her Minnie Mouse voice was gone, but so was she. And with that,
and you know what, John, and John, other deaths, I just want to mention, 36 years ago this month, actually on October 4th, 1969, Diane Linkletter took a header out of her penthouse apartment. Now she was close with Edward Durston. Okay, Edward Durston happened to be the boyfriend of a woman that appeared on Johnny Carson as, remember when he did those funny skits? Well, Edward Durston was her boyfriend, and I'm digging for the name here. I don't have it handy, but she drowned in about 2 inches of water when she was on vacation in Mexico. So Edward Durston is, or Carol Wayne is who I'm thinking of.
Oh, yes, of course.
All right. So, and just flowing from, I just want to, you know, connecting the dots on some of these suicides. Some deaths, yes, very, very, very sad. Suicide, strange deaths, Hollywood is rife with them.
And John,
I've got a few to share with you folks on the other side.
How do you want to do this on the other side? Do you want to call Mike at the top of the hour and the first 15 minutes we can get into the conference, or do you want to finish out and we can call him before the end of the show?
If we can pop
yeah,
it
I'd
to
like
a,
to,
go ahead.
Well, I'd like to do this because I'm almost done with the sort of the Hollywood historical show content, if you will. I've got maybe 5 minutes left on that. Then what I want to do is take about 5 minutes to recap on the two most critical points of the June 24th show, and that would be the baby breeders and the Gestapo control of Hollywood, because one of those two are what got me in trouble.
The Gestapo.
And then I'd like...
Gestapo.
Yep.
Yes.
That's right. The homosexual cartel stranglehold control of Hollywood. And I'm not sure if it's that one or if it's revealing of the baby breeders. And I had a chance to talk with Paul McGuire extensively last night, and he, I don't think he would mind me saying that he reiterated that, in fact, in the era of Jack Parsons, in the time of the making of Rosemary's Baby, that there are babies that are bred, that are birthed specifically for infanticide sacrifice.
Wow.
Hold that thought. Hold on.
We're at the break. We'll be right back on this Friday edition of the Hagman and Hagman Report. Stay with us.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to this fabulous Friday edition of the Hagman and Hagman Report. Doug Hagman, Joe Hagman, together we are the Hagman and Hagman Report. It is Friday, October 9th, 2015. Our guest today is John Robertson, giving an account, his account of his experiences in Hollywood. And as they say, the best is yet to come. I just want to, you know, it's so important why we're doing this, not only to explain, and I think that this is very important, it's not just to explain the predictive programming, the mind control, the Tavistock, links to Tavistock, the links to MIT and Stanford, the programming that goes on. And I know the audience knows all of this, but when you take a few steps backward and look at the wide angle view of what's going on, then you toss into the mix Laurel Canyon. And folks, did you know this? Laurel Canyon, and John, I'm not sure if you knew this about this or not, but and by the way, I'm gonna hold this up. I don't want to screw up the cameras here by doing this because the white balance. Okay, we have to be careful of the white balance. But
easy to do.
Two pages, front and back.
Yeah, I mean, these are my notes. I don't know exactly what size paper this is, but it's big. And these are just, I've got multiple pages front and back of this. But the reason I showed you this is because the links are so incredible. But when you start getting into the history of Hollywood, it's important to lay the foundation, because really everything that we see, the Gulf of Tonkin incident back in 1964, Admiral George Stephen Morrison, of course, was in charge of that ship. Well, his son is Jim Morrison of the Doors, okay? But by the way, Jim Morrison, he died suspiciously in Paris on July 3rd, 1971. Well, then you get into other things, but one of the issues, or one of the things that I found very interesting. Let me see if I have it over here. Lookout Mountain Laboratory was originally the Air Defense Center, and this is in Hollywood, or on the outskirts of Hollywood. Did you know, ladies and gentlemen, that there's a movie studio inside? It was built in 1941. It was operational through 1969. It may be, well, maybe even longer, but might still be operational. The Lookout Mountain Laboratory, get this. You talk about the incestuous relationship between Hollywood and the government. 19,000 classified films. United States Air Force has 19,000 classified films at that location. And some of the workers, the workforce at that location, at that facility, include, but are not limited to, Walt Disney, Marilyn Monroe, Jimmy Stewart, Ronald Reagan. And you needed clearance to work there. Is it still operational? And if so, and isn't it interesting, 1969, it was operational through. And what happened in 1969? We saw a lot of things in the aerospace industry. And that brings in Jack Parsons. That brings in people related to Jack Parsons. And, of course, CIA Project Bluebird, Project Artichoke. We have to kind of use those as footnotes. And, you know, when you start getting into this and laying this out in a flowchart-type fashion, John, it just makes your socks roll up and down, okay? It really does. You know, so
it certainly does. So, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. And I just want to say too, with the counterculture that we've discussed before, and you mentioned this, Rosemary's Baby, and how that filmed at the Dakota Building, and of course that's where John Lennon lived, and John Lennon was shot at the Dakota Building, outside of the Dakota Building, and of course the counterculture that we had with. All the people there, a name that everyone, I mean, if you really want to get into the real dark underbelly, Vito Policus, Vito and the Freaks, they were basically the first hippies of our generation. His wife, ZSOU, who actually ran hippie fashions, They had a son, Godot, dead at 3 years old. There's a question there as to what caused their son's death. And interestingly enough, on the day that Vito and Sue's wife, Palikos, on the day of their son Godot's death, they were partying heartily that night in Hollywood. Another place that's John, I know you're familiar with, Whiskey A Go Go.
Oh yeah.
Okay, it's live. You know, it was a really an interesting place for a meeting place for all of the people, and how all of these overlaid with Robert Heinlein, the science fiction writer. You had Carl Franzini. By the way, remember those people listening to this might remember the Gong Show with Chuck Barris. Well, Chuck Barris had his mitts in the CIA. People say, "Oh, that's just an urban legend. You can't prove that. That's all just BS." Look into it. I think there's enough anecdotal evidence there, or circumstantial evidence. In this case, circumstantial evidence to support Chuck Barris's role. And if so, what was the Gong Show, and you know what purpose did it serve? Because certainly it was ridiculous in terms of programming. So, having said all of that, John, I'm going to kick it back to you. I just went all over the place, but the flow chart, the flow of that's important. I think.
Absolutely. Allow me to jump in with a piece of chalk here. First of all, folks, quickly, going back to Disney, stage one on the Disney lot in Burbank is what's known as the Fantasia stage. Now, if you watch Fantasia through the third lens of Scripture, which is the lens that the Hagman and Hagman Report has been broadcasting through since its inception, you will note that Fantasia is nothing more than an ode to Greek mythology, to worship of deities and little g gods, to sorcery, and to go back to Paul McGuire's work, and I recommend again Prophecy of the Future of America. It's in the first few chapters. The idea of a man becoming a god king, replacing God, which is really the warped mental motivation that Lucifer himself can place in any person's open soul who's not got their Ephesians 6 armor on, is not covered in the blood of Christ, because that's what most of these Hollywood people are in fact trying to do. Now, you talk about the Palikas or the Palikas family, that segues, I was going to talk about some other horrific Hollywood deaths, but we'll save that for another time. I want to move right into what I believe got me in trouble from the June 24th show. Now, folks, again, I've enjoyed very much doing the June 24th show. If you've got time, go back and take a look, simply because it's really kind of like part one to what we're doing tonight. But to recap two specific points of that show, the most jarring thing that I discovered firsthand about this town. Now, Paul McGuire had touched on this earlier, like a year or two earlier, on the Hagman and Hagman Report, because it was wrapped up in the Jack Parsons clan, okay? And it's this notion of baby breeders, and it is heinous, and it is horrific, and it's murderous, and it's for real, and this is what it is. Multi-generational Illuminati families, they call themselves witches or initiates, and sometimes priests. Very rarely, if ever, I think, do they self-refer as Illuminati. Folks, whenever you hear the word initiate, you need to be exercising great discernment, because Christians, born-again Christians, those of us redeemed in the blood and resurrection of Christ, are received. We're received. You hear the word initiate or initiated, consider it the antithesis or the opposite, if you will, of the receiving of the love of Christ and the receiving of being blameless of your sin because it's been washed by the blood of Jesus. Watch out for the word initiate. I think Mr. Russ Dizdar would back me up on that. Here's how baby breeders work. Multi-generational witch families, they have the country divided up in a very militaristic fashion, okay? They have warlocks or high priests that control geographic areas. John Todd spoke of this quite a bit before his questionable demise in 2007. Incidentally, folks, if you want to read up and research some really interesting stuff, just simply go to YouTube and type in John with an H, J-O-H-N, Todd with two D's, T-O-D-D. I may tell his story on one of these shows eventually. I've been researching the man for about a year now. But what happens is these multi-generational witchcraft families will have a daughter, and they will randomly pull this 12 or 13-year-old, typically 12-year-old, young lady out of school, and they'll use any number of excuses, moving to a different state, moving to a different country, homeschooling, etc. And they will bring in a high priest from another coven, from somewhere else in the country or even somewhere else in the world. And that high priest will then begin to copulate with the minor, with the 12-year-old, until she becomes impregnated. 9 months pass, she's kept sequestered from her friends, from school, from the world. Often there are SRA type of things going on, satanic ritual abuse. The young lady may be a multiple from a very young age. Again, I think Russ Dizdar would probably have a lot to say about that. And ultimately what they do is she gives birth to a baby. They bring in a Wicca midwife who gives birth to the baby, who births the baby. And the baby has no paper trail at all, no birth certificate, no social security number, nothing. Then what happens is when Hollywood has a big film, a big project coming down the pike, okay, you know, executive produced by Satan himself, there are places of rite and ritual here in the Southern California basin. I'm pretty sure there's one up in Malibu that I'm aware of, where, just like the ancient Canaanites, they will heat up a statue of Moloch, which is this sort of twisted-looking owl with three eyes and comes right out of ancient Canaan. And they will heat the statue up white hot, and then after performing incantations and satanic rites and rituals, they will then toss the defenseless child onto the white hot statue of Moloch, where the child will then sizzle and immolate as though tossed into a large cast iron skillet. They believe that this burning sacrifice of the innocent gives satanic power to the project. Now, that's called baby breeders. And you can do, if you're willing to put on your Ephesians 6 armor and you're not afraid of this kind of stuff, I recommend you chase Jesus first. But if you're interested in this type of thing, just do some searches. Start with Start Page, because you don't want this kind of stuff traced to your IP, but just type in baby breeders and it'll take you where you need to go if you want to study more on baby breeders. The baby breeder thing is real. I know it. Paul McGuire knows it. Russ Dizdar knows it. Doug and Joe know it. Okay. I'm not saying it happens every day in Hollywood, but it certainly happens every year. There have been presidents implicated in this. Okay. Presidents that have been president within the last 25 years. That may be what got me in trouble with what I'm about to describe. It's either that or my description of what they colloquially call the Gestapo. I'm just going to gloss over this because, again, I go into great detail on that June 24th show. The Gestapo is the homosexual control. It's the homosexual cartels that control. They literally have a stranglehold over everything that happens in Hollywood, from the development of talent to the development of projects to what kind of scripts are made. And I would point out, interestingly, that I've noticed just since June 24th that they hand us scripts in the morning that often reflect whatever the last one or two 24-hour news cycles are covering. It's amazing how fast they can punch these things out, which probably accounts for why they're such garbage, in a literary definition. But Hollywood is controlled by gay men, most of whom pretend to be heterosexual during their business dealings and their day-to-day goings-ons. But at night, they throw these massive all-male orgies, and what they will often do is rig these parties with what are, they call them lipstick cams, as in cameras, but they're much smaller than that now. They can fit in doorknobs, and they can fit in electrical outlets and stuff like that. And what they'll do is they'll take new up-and-coming stars, typically male stars, and they will place them in grotesque vile, homosexual dispositions, okay, with multiple partners, all on film. They'll do bloodletting. They'll do animal sacrifice. They will place these individuals in a position or positions whereby Once they've got that on film, they own that person for the rest of their lives. They own them. You'll do the scripts they say. You won't do the scripts they don't. You'll support the quote-unquote pro-choice baby butchery movement. You will go to the charities they tell you. You will go to the press things they tell you. You will do exactly what they tell you, including, and perhaps we can cover this next time, but I've been uncovering quite a bit of evidence pointing to the fact, I never thought I would even believe this, but there's an awful lot of evidence pointing to it, Doug and Joe, that many stars actually sacrifice members of their families in order to gain that stardom. We'll have to cover that next time. Okay, moving on to the show that I was just on, the one that I just got fired from. It's a big show. It's going to come out in March. It is a replacement series, which means whatever show gets swept in November, December will be replaced by the show I was just on. It's going to be a big show. It is created by the writers and the producers of another huge hit show that just got canceled. I am under non-disclosure. These people don't like me, and I don't like them. So, but the difference is their wallet is much, much bigger than mine. So as much as I'd love to just burn the show to the stake right now, I can't because I'm under non-disclosure, and I am under non-disclosure for another 12 months. I will say this. Greg Jackson and I, about a month ago, and you know this, Doug, because we talked about it. Greg Jackson and I were talking about doing a show, on abortion and on the Supreme Court opinion regarding homosexual marriage.
Yeah.
And he and I were both starting to research show content. We were talking on the phone pretty regularly, and he was covering more of the D.C. angle with the Supreme Court opinion. I was covering the Hollywood angle with the release of the Planned Parenthood baby butchery tapes, the videos that showed the eating of salad and drinking of wine while brokering fetuses. I remember one Sunday afternoon I was researching some of the just the murderous abortionists. I'm talking like post-birth abortionists, and I couldn't believe how many were out there. And the research, I'd never researched a show quite in this way, but the research was literally making me sick. And that was on a Sunday afternoon. I got up and went to work the following morning on the show that I just left. And I'm standing on stage with all six principals. This is kind of a ensemble cast, okay? So all six principals, that means the first six people on the call sheet. And I stood there on the set, not, 12, maybe 15 hours after sitting at this desk I'm sitting at right now doing this abortion research. And I listened to these people make fun of the Planned Parenthood videos, make fun of the entire effort to get them out to the public, and moreover, make fun of abortion from the pro-life angle. And I just felt sick to my stomach, and I felt like such a jerk and such a traitor. Here I am working with Greg Jackson, one of the God-ordained, watchmen on the wall, not to mention just a great guy. By the way, he's going to be on Caravan to Midnight next week. But, we're working together to bring a stellar show to the Hagman and Hagman Report. Granted, the material's rough. That's what I'm working on my spare time. But at work, I'm listening to these overpaid clowns that I'm directly supporting with my craft make fun of it. And I thought, how twisted can this possibly be? How warped can this possibly be to listen to these people make fun of such a thing? I mean, that just flies in the face of basic human decency. I mean, my goodness. I would also like to point out that same episode of that show, as the number two story, the sub story, which all television scripts have, was all about vaccinations. Got to get your flu vaccine, vaccinations. That was the entire sub story of the script. So for about 8 weeks, I stumbled around in this show, showing up every day at work, feeling like a hypocritical Christian, and feeling like just kind of a lost guy. Like God blessed me with the platform to do these shows, with acquaintances and friendships with people like Doug and Joe and Paul and Greg and Chance and American Survival Wholesale and Pastor Wingford and all these wonderful people. And yet, what am I doing standing here? Why am I still here? What am I doing here? Like, I have no more business being here than I do being in a strip club or drunk in a bar. So I began to feel really uncertain about what I was doing. And then on Friday the 18th, Friday, September 18th, we were two-thirds of the way through our day on this show when the unit production manager and my other direct supervisor, whose title shall remain unnamed because it gets too close for comfort, they came down to stage and they pulled me out of the set midway through the day. Well, two-thirds of the way through the day, we were about to move from our larger stages to our smaller one. We were about to do a company move and wrap up a couple scenes for the end of the day, and then that was going to be it. And these two people, the UPM and the other individual, had looks on their faces of total disbelief. Like, they looked like they had just, you know, been told that the earth is flat or something. And the UPM, who had never said a word to me in the entire time I've been on the show, by the way, the UPM is unit production manager, he said, "John, we've been advised that you've been demonstrating behavior on set that is contrary to the show." And he said the show's title. What we're going to do is send you home. And I knew right then and there, well, this means I'm terminated. We're going to send you home, and there will be a human resources hearing on Monday. Now, this was on a Friday. It was Friday, September 18th. I knew right then and there that something was terribly, terribly wrong. I had no idea.
Can I ask what studio this was again? Or don't you want to say?
I do want to say, but my dad and Paul McGuire both advised me against it. Let's put it this way. It's one of the six biggies.
Okay.
Universal, Disney, Warner, Fox, Sony, or Paramount. It's one of the six biggies. Let's just put it that way.
Okay.
So I was escorted off the set, and in fact escorted to my car off the lot, and I wasn't contacted for a week, at which time I was contacted by the unit production manager, rather, and I was told that there would be a meeting at the corporate tower, which they call the Black Tower. People in the industry right away will know which studio it was. So they took me up to the Black Tower to a boardroom for this HR hearing. Now, I had 3 hours advanced warning. I was able to get a union rep there, but I had nowhere near enough time to get an attorney there. Doug and Joe, they started out by asking me questions like this. "So, John, do you consider yourself a very huggy type person?" "Excuse me?" "Well, do you like to hug a lot? You know, are you a huggy type guy?" And I said, "Well, it depends on where I'm at. If I'm among brethren, if I'm in a church foyer, for example, sure, I might give out 10 hugs in 5 minutes, but not on set. And if I am a huggy person on set, believe me, I probably give out more one-arm bro hugs than I would give hugs to women, because we work in such a sensitive environment." So they would ask me, they're two guys playing good cop, bad cop. So they would ask me a question like that. And then they would say, "Well, do you recall giving so-and-so, a female employee, a hug and a kiss on the top of the head?" And I was like, "No." And then I thought about it, and I went, "Oh, yes, you know what? Yes, I did. And I actually know this person very well." And she had been sick. She was worried about having bronchitis. And I did give her a kiss on the top of the head, and I said, "I hope you feel better." Probably shouldn't have done that, but nonetheless, it was a gesture of friendship. It had nothing to do with romance, and zero to do with romance. Then they would ask me a question like this. "Are you like a knee-grabbing type person? Do you like to kind of grab people's knees a little bit?" And I'm going, I'm starting to get irritated. I'm going,
A knee-grabbing person?
Yeah, I've never heard that before. I've never even heard those words strung together before. So what's happening is they're putting me into a backpedaling defensive mode, and I'm kind of starting to get irritable too, okay, because these questions are ludicrous.
By design.
Then they started, and so I said, "Well, no, I'm not a knee-grabbing person. I don't touch people's knees ever." And they go, "Well, we've got a couple of employees who have gone on record saying that you tap them on the knee." And I said, wait a second. "We work on dark sound stages. It is very common, if you're standing amongst people, to tap them on the shoulder when you need their attention, or if you're all sitting, for example, around the video monitors, to tap them on the knee." And that's a tap. That's a tenth of a second little boop to get their attention, because you can't talk, they're rolling sound. "That's very common. Everybody does it." Okay, so now this guy's got a big smirk on his face. "Well, you just told us you're not a knee-grabbing person, but now you're telling us that, in fact, you do tap people on the knee. So which is it?" Now I'm getting really irritated. But then they started to ask me questions that only people who know me well could possibly know. They asked me some questions about people from HH Connections. They asked me questions about my titular involvement with the show. They didn't come right out and say, are you doing, you know, internet radio that would be offensive to us? They can't do that because that would open them up to litigation. So what they did was they sort of framed me as some sort of out of control sexual harassment guy, which couldn't be further from the truth. I mean, it was really insulting. And in fact, when my dad heard about this, he was just ready to go. He was ready to start suing everybody in sight. And they said, I knew why I was sitting there. I knew it was the shows. From the stuff they were letting slip out, they were saying things that only people that I'm directly involved with CTM and with Hagman and Hagman Report, they knew things that I would discuss with Chance, for example. Okay. So that got scary and it got creepy. We concluded the meeting. They said that they would take 2 or 3 days to reach their decision, that I would either be reprimanded verbally or I would have a written reprimand placed in my corporate file, or I would be, or it would be decided that I would no longer work for the company or its affiliates. My union rep said, listen, John, you lack what they call progression of discipline. You've never been disciplined for any of these allegations before on this lot or on any of the other major lots or anywhere else we can find in your personnel files. So without progression of discipline, they're not going to ban you from the lot. Well, 3 or 4 days later, I got a call from the union rep, and he said, bad news, John, they're going to ban you for life. You can no longer work for this company. And this company encompasses a major film studio, one of the three major networks, and a major cable company. It's a huge chunk of job market lost. And the job I lost was a six-figure-a-year job. And I said to my union rep, how can they do that without showing progression of discipline? And this is when I knew that something was really, really wrong in this story. He said, John, in the interim 3 days, everybody that registered a complaint about you went back up to the office and said that each of them had individually asked you to stop this behavior, but you proceeded with it anyway over a period of time. I flipped my lid. My poor union rep, I mean, I hate to admit it, but I threw down a slew of curses, and that's about the hottest I've gotten in probably the last 5 years. I just was so angered that these people would do this to me. And then, and this is my final part of the story, Doug and Joe, and then I'll answer any questions you may have. Then I realized that of all the shows I've done, I think I've done about 130 shows over 16 years, and I think of those 130, I've probably done maybe 40 of them full time, which is to say I wasn't a day player. I started to think about these people that I could tell by the vernacular when they were reading quotes off this dossier that they were using as allegations against me. They had 15 pages of single-spaced typed allegations, 15 pages. It was a stack. And then I thought about these four people, and I realized all four of these people had befriended me in a manner completely different from any other show I've ever worked on. Like, hey, let's have lunch together today, or hey, you want to join the gym together, me and you? Hey, and one of the girls would constantly ask me about Jesus, but she would do it in a really combative way where she'd be like, convince me that there's this man who rose again. I mean, convince me, give me what you got, John. And I would tell her, listen, I have been fired from jobs in the past for this. We can talk about this outside of work, you know, off company time, anytime you like. I would love to discuss it with you. But it's not a debatable topic. It's a story, and it's a story of faith, and I'd love to share it with you, but not here. So I started to think, and this is what I'm thinking now, Doug and Joe, I think I might have been to a degree set up, because there's no slop in the story. There's no loose ends. It's all too tight. It's airtight. So to conclude the story, 3 days ago I received a FedEx letter in the mail, and I have been banned for life from the said studio. And by the way, Paul's recommendation was, don't give that studio the power of name recognition on the Hagmans. That was his whole point, and I agree with him.
That's a good.
This is our
really
show,
good.
Not
yes.
Their show.
Right.
Okay. So what they're doing is sinful and it's wrong. And I'm not going to give them voice on this platform. The same way, Doug, you wouldn't give voice to that shooter in Oregon last week. So I received that letter, and I will no longer be working for this consortium. It probably takes 20 to 30% of my job market away. And I think it's the Lord. Paul looked at me last night and he said, John, he had a big smile on his face. He's like, John, the Lord just dropped a big, fat, holy meat cleaver into your life. He's telling you to move on, man, so just do it. What are you afraid of? And I said, well, I guess I'm afraid of finances. And Paul broke out. He said, are you married? And I said, no. And he broke out laughing. He said, what do you have to worry about? Look at you. You've got your backpack on. Go find a friend's couch to sleep on, man. Get to work.
I love it.
It was great. So anyway, that's what's happened, folks. The bottom line is this. I came forth on February 17th spontaneously and started talking about Hollywood on the Hagman and Hagman Report with my brothers, Doug and Joe. That developed into a full three-hour show on June 24th, which brings us to tonight. Well, and then that show got me Caravan to Midnight, which was that's a whole other story, but that was a huge blessing, big surprise too. But and then that brings us to where we're at tonight. The point is that I was acting the coward, and I was proving myself to be unwilling to step out in faith and to say, I'm done with this devil factory. I'm going to move forward. I don't know how I'm going to pay the bills, but I'm going to do it. Now, I've got one quick verse I want to read from 2 Samuel, and then Doug and Joe, I'm going to turn it over to you until we bring Mike on. I think we have about 10 minutes. You can tell us about the impetus of the Hagman and Hagman Report. Does that sound good?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, folks, this is from 2 Samuel 22, verses 31 through 38, King James Version. For who is God save the Lord? And who is a rock save our God? God is my strength and power, and he maketh my way perfect. He maketh my feet like hinds. I put parenthetically, that means deer's, like deer's feet. And setteth me upon high places. He teacheth my hands to war, so that a bow of steel is broken by mine arms. Thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation, and thy gentleness hath made me great. Thou hast enlarged my steps under me. I'm going to repeat that. Thou hast enlarged my steps under me, so that my feet did not slip. I have pursued mine enemies and destroyed them, and turned not again until I had consumed them. And again, that's 2 Samuel 22, verses 31 through 38. That about does it for me for my content for tonight, folks. But Doug and Joe, I'd love to bounce it back to you for the remaining time before Mike comes on. Please share with myself and with the Hagman and Hagman family, tell us what it was like stepping out in faith and moving from the world of investigations to the Hagman and Hagman Report. I think we'd all really be fascinated to hear it.
Hey John, before we do that, just I want to take 60 seconds and just say this. You know, thank you for your standing up for your beliefs. Thank you for not folding with, you know, the integrity. I suppose we now know, and we've always known, that there are people inside Hollywood, inside the Beltway, inside the various centers of power and influence in this country on the earthly plane, who are listening, who are watching, and who are reaching out and punishing. And that leads me to this. I mean, just as you have suffered, John Robertson has suffered economically. He suffered for being a Christian and speaking out against the satanic, speaking out against the occult, speaking out against the just the profane, and speaking up for our Lord and Savior. Now, having said all of that, you have to dial it back to when Steve was on our program. You see, in us, and this is going to move us right into to answer your question. But folks, you can understand. Okay, there are people out there like John experienced in the arena, in the earthly arena, the bad people. I mean, very bad people who are wanting. I mean, they're going after John personally and professionally, and making him suffer economically. There are people going after us, and have gone after us, and Steve Quayle. That's why when you heard Steve Quayle coming on and saying what he did say, you've got to know the backstory. And Steve really won't tell you the backstory. He'll tell you about the emailers, but he won't tell you about the vexatious litigants who have nothing better to do than to throw lawsuits after, or not lawsuits, but complaints, you know, public complaints by to the various government agencies against us, against Steve Quayle, without foundation or basis. That's what we're fighting against. And so please understand, there's a huge and a very vicious, extremely vicious agenda right now taking place. And, you know, with, even though the complaints, are, you might say, well, if the complaints are without foundation, what do you have to worry about? You got to get an attorney. You have to, just because you better get an attorney, okay, or you better have one. And then you've got to answer the complaints, even though they're baseless and such. And then you might say, well, you can go after these people for filing, you know, being vexatious litigants. Sure, you could if they had any money. Okay, this is the unseen war against the Christians right now. We are being victimized. John Robertson's a victim, and others as well.
And back to what you said, John, and asked. It's kind of a long story, but in 5 minutes we can do it here and do it some justice. My dad's been a private investigator for 30 years now. He's owned his own private investigation company for a long time, and I started working with him back as a kid, and then in a professional capacity in my early 20s, and I was a troublemaker back then, and we would, you know, he would work hard, and a lot of the work was out of town, New York State, Ohio, and Pennsylvania, never really locally, except in the beginning of his work when I was a kid. But towards the end, you know, we were working in New York City, 1 week there, 1 week home, 1 week there, 1 week home. It was very taxing, and somehow, you know, I went through some personal troubles, ended up in jail and with a criminal record, and had to go through some personal rehabilitation, and got back on my feet, started working with my dad again, and we started to have intellectual discussions about current events and politics and, you know, 9/11, and started listening to alternative news, and we kind of both woke up in our own ways. I started moving more spiritually after I understood what was going on with the world, and my dad was waking up to the things of the world. Well, a long story short, we started a radio show on Saturday nights from 8 to 10 just for to be able to get our opinion out there to see if what we were discussing was of common interest to what other people were discussing, and it was never talked about. Actually, Judy McLeod, owner of Canada Free Press, started the show with my dad. It was the McLeod-Hagman Report, and she did not like doing the radio show for whatever reason, so my dad asked if I'd like to step in with him on Saturdays, and we started doing that. A network called Red State Radio Network picked up our Saturday show, and we ended up in the beginning of 2012 starting, you know, 5 days a week on Liberty Broadcasting Network. And as you said, John, that, you know, the Lord will close a door, but it'll open 1,000 others. We were on that network with Pastor Paul Begley. Something happened with the owner, and we weren't sure what we were going to do. We had no network. We had a show. We had a base of following of listeners. And we went on Blog Talk Radio on our own. And Steve Quayle helped us out and got us some guests lined up, and we started our first month of programming. Without any conversations of really starting a show, any plans of being radio show hosts, we were private investigators.
And I'll just say this, during this time, because this kind of reflects what you went through, John. I was called in, one of our biggest clients, or my biggest clients, I should say, business-wise, Fortune 100 company, 85% of the business that I had as a company called me up and said, we don't like what you're publicly saying. We don't like your public positions, especially with respect to your Christianity, conservative. You cannot be a vocal Christian,
yeah,
and be a private investigator. So you're going to have to choose.
We went through a number of those, one with the private investigation company, another one with and the latest one with a group of advertisers,
yep,
on through Blog Talk Radio. And before that, on my wedding day, GoDaddy, the website carrier, GoDaddy, basically banned the business, our website, from being on there due to the content.
We had 48 hours to get our website off of the server, GoDaddy servers, and I remember this, and let me just say, you know, the BS.
And that was on my wedding night. It was the 48 hours.
It was the you got married Saturday. That was Friday. We were notified.
Wow, that's terrible on your wedding. That's,
yeah,
horrible.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Go ahead. No, I mean, but you know, it's just the way it is. It was almost poetic.
And I know Mike's with us, and he's holding. And if we can sum it up, I just want to say this: the Lord had led us he put us here. He knew the direction we were going in. He knew, you know, the set behind us was going to be here, but we were going to be here in 2015. In 2012, we didn't know what we were doing or why we were doing it.
Well, I'm not sure we still know what we're doing, to be honest with you.
We do know why, though. And we can only give credit to the Lord. The Lord has put us and all the listeners in our lives. The Lord has put the guests in our lives. The Lord has done so much for us, and it has opened my heart and so many friendships, and just it's indescribable the ways the Lord has worked in our lives. And to two people who really didn't deserve it in the first place, it is something that's hard to explain in words.
And we always want to, and this is to the listeners, this is to you, and this is to everybody, we want to be good stewards, okay? We know this show is not ours. This show is much bigger than Joe and I, and we have no, absolutely no designs. I mean, we understand our place in this show, okay? We understand that we're just doing what we're supposed to be doing. We're answering the call, and failure to do so, in my view, would be almost rebellious to God. So we understand that this is not us. This has nothing whatsoever to do with us, except we're just here as placeholders for and kind of funnels for the Word of God. And we have, trust me on this, we have no other agenda, and that's it. So,
you know, gentlemen, let me do this just for the benefit of the Hagman family. This will take 30 seconds, and we'll go to Mike. For the benefit of everyone who spent time with us tonight, and folks, thank you for your time. I know how valuable it is, you know, especially for spending a Friday evening with us. And Doug and Joe, as always, thank you for your trust in me and for again giving me a platform. I'm going to conclude with just this single verse. I think it's just perfect for what you just shared with us, Doug and Joe. It's from 1 Peter. This is 1 Peter 2:21, and I'll make this my concluding remark for this evening's show. 1 Peter 2:21, for even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. I'm gonna read that one more time. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Gentlemen, I'm gonna mute myself out. Thank you so much for having me on this evening. Mike, I'm ready to hear from you, brother. God bless you all.
Thanks, well, God bless you, John. You were awesome tonight. I thoroughly enjoyed listening to you. We have Jeannie has joined us, my wife. She's on the line as well. Are you there, Jeannie?
I am.
Hi,
we're just blessed to be here. Doug, you said it so well. I mean, Jeannie and I are just stewards of this effort from God to bring the Remnant family together in what we're doing. Which is Hear the Watchmen. Your listeners can find details, complete details, at hearthewatchmen.com. And we're just thrilled. You know, the whole thing has just really taken off. We were blessed to visit Sandpoint, Idaho, and we went to a conference there that Nathan Liao and Ben Baruch put on. And, you know, Nathan just, he was anointed. He delivered a message at that conference that moved Jeannie and I in a way that it's hard for me to put into words. And I'll tell you what, if you're up here in the northwest quadrant of the United States, you know, you want to go to Nathan's website, which is Watchman's Cry. You want to take a look. On November 13th and 14th, in Priest River, he'll be doing another revival, and Jeannie and I will be there for that. It's just an amazing thing. All of this was really birthed out of Whitestone. And, you know, Dud, I met you guys there, and it's kind of a funny story. You know, I was not really awake yet at that time, and I was, you know, I was going to work, and my wife was suddenly listening to some radio show on the internet every single night. I mean, for 3 hours every night, she's listening to two guys, you know, called the Hagmans somewhere in the country, and she's talking to me about all this stuff and this other guy named Steve Quayle, and I'm just trying to make a living and sort things out in my own life. And one day I came home to pull in the garage, and I couldn't get in the garage because there was a pallet of all this dried food and a solar generator sitting in the middle of the garage. And I didn't know what was going on, but she told me that she was going to Lightstone to go to this conference, and it was in Bozeman, Montana. And I said, you know what? I want to go with you. And she thought I wanted to go just to find out who she was listening to and who she was hanging out with. But I wanted to go trout fishing. I was going to go up there and do some fishing. I was going to, you know, just have a good time while she hung out with everybody at the conference. But, you know, I went into the conference with her, and something took over. It was the presence of God that took over with me. And this guy came walking in, fumbling around with a bunch of books. And I asked him if he needed some help with his books, and I ended up sitting at a table with Steve Quayle for 3 days, helping him hand out his books and talking with him and meeting you guys and hearing the word of the Lord, and it totally changed my life. And as we went on, you know, things happened in our lives, and I had been on my knees praying to the Lord and asking the Lord, like, please give me something to do with our lives, you know. And the Lord came to us and said, you know, that you're responsible for gathering my family. And that's what we're doing with Hear the Watch. You know, we have a great lineup. We have Nathan Leal. We have both you guys. The Hagmans will be there, so you can come and meet the Hagmans. We have Greg Jackson, Sheila Zielinski, Benjamin Baruch, John, who was just on, he'll be there, and Pastor David Langford, who actually baptized me at Whitestone. So, you know, it's just truly, it's the presence of God. And when we were in Sandpoint and listening to Nathan Leal and the revival portion, you know, it was, God was in that room. And it was an amazing, amazing thing to watch and feel what was going on. And that's what we want to deliver in Dallas. And we want to take Hear the Watchman to as many cities across the country as we possibly can as we're coming into these times. Jeannie, you have something to add to that?
Well, I just wanted to say that even before Whitestone, God had told me to do a conference. And like John, I actually got fired from my job in April. The conference was in May. And I was dumbfounded. I came to work after a hugely successful event that I had done for an event planning company. And I was hired on a kite, feeling great, and I walked in the door, and this woman, the owner of the company, hands me this piece of paper and said, I am terminating you for cause, and if you try to collect unemployment, I will fight you. And it was the weirdest thing. Like, I'm looking at her like, what? It was a total shock. She's not a believer. I worked with very, you know, materialistic people who I didn't particularly care for, but it was a job. And that freed me up to go to Whitestone. And God has, it's funny how God works. You know, he frees us up to do things, whether we like it or not. He brings us opportunities. And I'm the type, when I hear from God, I jump on it. But sometimes God tells us things, and it's not the right time. Like, we get inspired. He tells us what to do, but it's all in his perfect timing. And I don't know about you guys, but I can't think of a better time to bring God's people together again. I mean, times are really, really tense right now. And when we went to Nathan's event up in Idaho, it was just, you know, we were craving another Whitestone, and I had no idea that Nathan was so anointed as a worship leader. That man is anointed.
It was amazing.
Oh, I mean, we're talking like big 6'5", 6'2", burly men with beards, and, you know, we're talking tough guys at this event. There were about 300 people there. They were bawling like babies because Nathan had a way of bringing worship into the room and making it such a safe place where if there was anything stirring our hearts, anything blocking us from receiving the Holy Spirit fully, you know, anything that, any resentment, any habits, anything that we were doing that we knew was not of the Lord, it absolutely convicted us because we were in a faith-loving environment. And it was so powerful. I've never experienced anything quite like it. And we got so inspired. And so we just want everyone to know that we're just being obedient. We're just administrators, really. That's all we are.
You know, it's important, Gina, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but we've only got a couple of minutes left here. And you know, I just want everybody to know, go to hearthewatchman.com. You can see the, you know, the entire story. That's hearthewatchman.com. Go online. You can go online and get your tickets. You know, people ask us, like, oh, you have to pay? Yes, there is a $99 ticket fee for all 3 days of this event, and nobody's making any money. The money that we raise doing those tickets helps us to cover the cost, because Jeannie and I are doing this out of the goodness of our hearts, trying to bring people together, and we just hope to be able to recoup the cost. You can also go to that site and donate. And Doug, Joe, you know, we're just so grateful to you guys for letting us have some time and for everything that you've done. And you know, you guys saved our lives. You really did, at a time when Jeannie and I were kind of going through some tough stuff. You guys really saved us. You know, we hope that we can bring people together in Dallas and then in Atlanta and then in other cities across the country, have that feeling and to get together as family, because it's important now. You know, we spent so much time preparing, and we're preppers, you know, but now it's time to prepare with God. And so I know it's, you know, $99 is not easy for everybody to find, but, you know, don't go buy any AK rounds this month. Just save your money up and come to Dallas, hear the word of God, and be with us.
And Jeannie, Mike, I want to thank both of you guys for your friendship, all the work that you've done behind the scenes, you know, Amen. The involvement to HH Connections, the volunteering your time and your efforts, and Jeannie, the toffee you make is just fantastic. Mike, it was a blessing meeting both you and Jeannie in Montana, and really looking forward to seeing you again in Dallas, and really thank you so much for putting in the time and the effort to make this happen. And I hope this is the beginning of many of movements in the Lord we can put together, that the Holy Spirit directly speaks to each individual person, whether they're there or watching it live stream or however they hear or receive that information. And we'll keep you in our prayers. And folks, please keep them in your prayers, Mike and Jeannie. And you can go to hearthewatchmen.com and contact them.
That's linked right off of HagmanandHagman.com. Easy, if you bookmark Hagman, just go check the right hand side, hearthewatchman.com. And exactly, Joe, I want to echo your sentiments to both Jeannie and Mike, and just tremendous people who really, you know, are trying to do something very special for the listeners. And I mean, I really think this is really molded for the listeners of our show and Nathan Leal and others, and just thank you for all of that. And I know that this comes at great personal sacrifice, and I'm sorry, Jeannie, for if our show got you fired.
Hey, it saved our marriage, so it's all good.
Amen to that. Guys, we're at the very end of the program. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Jeannie. God bless you both. May the Lord be with you. And we'll be talking soon. All right, guys, until next week, that'll do it for us here on Global Star Radio Network. Thank you, Todd. Thank you, JD. Thank you, Eric, and all the guests this week. We'll be back next week.
And listen to Global Star Radio Network this weekend. Dave Hodges, Ted Brewer.
Yeah.
You know, they're part of the
Global
Star.
They've got great
programming. Absolutely.
When we're not on and when we're on, it's okay.
Well, it's, yeah.
Have a good weekend, everyone.
Good night.
All right, great show.